Hello there, ladies and gentlemen, presenters, moderators. My name is Sarah Lowther, and a very warm welcome to this Cenkos Securities Proactive Investor Growth and Innovation Forum. Today, we have 23 presenters, and they will be presenting in a sort of speed dating type format. 10 minutes presenting and 5 minutes Q&A. So let me tell you a little bit about Cenkos Securities. With over 100 clients and more than £1 billion raised last year, Cenkos Securities focuses on growth companies and investment trusts. Well, leading this growing company is the relatively new Chief Executive, Julian Morse. A very warm welcome to you, Julian.
Thank you very much. So as has been said, I'm Julian Morse, the CEO of Cenkos Securities. It's my great pleasure to have the opportunity to welcome everybody to the 9th Cenkos Growth and Innovation Conference. Thank you very much to Proactive and PrimaryBid for their support in helping prepare such an engaging program for today. Cenkos is proud to be associated with it. The challenging circumstances of the past 15 months have not dampened interest in this event, nor to the wider growth company scene. The AIM market, home of most of the UK's most exciting growth companies, is up over 40% in the last 12 months, significantly outperforming the FTSE All Share, which is up only 13%. The continued strength of the capital markets is shown here today, and we are fortunate to hear from a whole host of compelling growth companies from wide-ranging sectors. Alongside this, we have keynote addresses from two of the most respected investors in this space, Gervais Williams and Richard Penny. Many thanks to them for making time in their busy schedules to contribute to this event. We at Cenkos have been encouraged by the continued appetite and demand for quality growth stories and are proud to have guided growth companies successfully through uncertain times, raising over £1 billion during 2020, including four lockdown IPOs. And previous to that, the largest company to IPO in the whole of 2020 on AIM. And we see many reasons for optimism through 2021. The recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic, fueled by vaccinations in Western countries and easing of social restrictions, is set to fuel GDP growth of 7.25% in 2021. This will be the highest watermark since Britain put itself on a war footing, ramping up production and resulting in 8.7% growth rate. The spring back follows a fall, which we all know about, of 10% in 2020. This was the biggest fall since 1709, when the Great Frost was responsible for GDP contracting by 13%. Luckily, we've got the good weather at the moment. We don't see that happening anytime soon. The construction sector expanded last month at its fastest rate in nearly 7 years as the lifting of lockdown restrictions led to a surge in new orders. Growth was driven by the house builders as orders continued to rise in a booming property market. Latest official data suggests that house prices rose by a record 10% last month. This was followed by a rise in commercial work, which expanded at its sharpest pace since August 2007. Easing lockdown restrictions has lifted consumer confidence to its highest level since before the European Union referendum. Britain is the most attractive destination in Europe for foreign investors and gained more last year than any country except France, according to the EY Attractiveness Survey. It is noted that Britain has attracted the most new projects rather than relying on reinvestments. Businesses reported a sharp rise in new orders, which recovered at their fastest pace since October 2013. Smaller and growth companies create all the employment in the UK and are the driver of our economy. Higher levels of demand led businesses to take on staff, and employment grew at its quickest pace for just over 6 years. Investing is not without its risks, however, and we feel strongly that the combination of an established marketplace, clear governance, ESG expectations, and the ongoing support from knowledgeable advisors allow companies the latitude to thrive. Importantly, this combination also provides investors with a degree of comfort and, one hopes, shelter from some of the prominent events we have witnessed recently across markets more broadly. These are the ingredients for a successful partnership. The balance of companies reaching their potential and shareholders sharing that success need not be mutually exclusive. This event is an example of that transparent and productive partnership in action. On that note, Cenkos has always had positive feedback from both our management teams and attendees on how interactive and informative this event is, and I hope you find the same to be true this year. I'd now like to hand over to a gentleman that I've had the pleasure of introducing many high growth quality companies to over the years and who has given us incredibly useful insights. Gervais Williams, Head of Equities at Premier Miton.
Thank you very much, Julian, and thank you very much for the opportunity to come and speak today. The title of the talk today is, now that the UK has started outperforming the US, what is the scale of the upside and how long will the new trend last? Of course, none of us know, but I've got some pretty strong views about the thing. As always, there's always a risk slide in all presentations. For those who don't know me, I've been around as a fund manager for over 30 years, particularly investing in small quoted companies, but across the whole of the UK stock market into a total. So I thought the starting point we'd go with is just how much markets have moved up. If you had invested in an index fund in the FTSE 100 30 years ago, you would have made about 4.5 times your money, including income along the way. But of course, we all know that money's been made in the US. If you'd bought a NASDAQ, it would have been up 22-fold. If you'd been in the S&P, it'd been up 22-fold. If you'd been in NASDAQ, you would have been up nearly 40-fold. So extraordinary returns and so much bigger returns outside of the UK rather than in the UK. If you look at more recently, though, the pattern hasn't been so obvious. This is from the middle of last year, June of last year. Yes, the NASDAQ's up. Yes, the S&P's up. But actually, the all-share index is up a little further, which is slightly against the previous trend. And when you look at smaller quoted companies, what you do see is that actually they've had a very good start in the last 12 months to the recovery after a pandemic. And I think it's is this just a short-term trend or is it something which is going to last a lot longer? Well, that's the big question. I think we might be in for something rather more sustaining. So why is that? Well, first of all, when you look at the pattern we've seen in terms of cash, and I think cash is really important in terms of stock markets, because basically it's not a judgment, it's an actual fact. This is income generated by UK companies. This is some data from the Linked Dividend Monitor. Specifically, you can see how the UK market has been rising in terms of income from about 60 billions per year up to about 110 billions per year. The blue is the ordinary dividends. There have been some specials on top. But as you know, last year, things got pretty tough. And that's because many of the companies have been growing their dividends faster than their earnings. So their dividend cover had been coming down. Companies have been using the low interest rates to actually improve the ability of them to actually pay dividends. And so they took some debt on. And when we had the pandemic last year, it wasn't just the fall in earnings. It was the fact they were over-distributing cash and were more geared than they liked to be. Of course, going forward, we don't know how bad things will get. At this stage, we're going through a bit of a pickup in inflation. A lot of cash was invested by the governments around the world. And by central banks. And that has led to all sorts of bottlenecks all around, not just the UK economy, but global economy. And we don't quite know how long this period of uncertainty is going to last, but it could be for much longer than we think. On top of that, of course, we've seen a radical change in the attitude of the electorate over recent years. Specifically, we've had a period when actually, QE has been distorting market prices really since about 2008. And if you keep distorting market prices again and again, you get misallocated capital. And when misallocated capital obviously means that you don't get the best out of your returns, then ultimately productivity has been stagnating around the world. And that's one of the reasons why wage growth hasn't been as high as we'd like it to be. And that means that when you're asking the electorate, do you want more of the same? They feel very much uncertain about that. They would argue, actually, they're looking for things differently. And that's why we've got such a big flux in the way that people are voting, not just in terms of Trump being elected in the US or Brexit in the UK, but around the world, there's a real flux. And we saw it recently with the UK elections in 2019, that people were voting differently to their previous heritage for the last 30 years. So we've got much more flux in the way that people are voting, and that's going to lead to real political pressures. We're going to see a lot more pressure, effectively, for the stock market to be socially useful. Now, at its heart, the stock market is socially useful. We take savings collectively from people, and then we invest it into companies which then generate more employment, more domestic growth, and ultimately they drive more tax take for the governments, which is good for the nations. But if you're not socially useful, you're going to come under pressure. And I think quite a lot of big companies, which are getting cash from overseas and they're not investing locally and such like, paying low taxes through areas which are low tax regimes. Effectively, I think this is going to be a really unsettled period. And I think there's going to be real political pressure coming in a way we haven't really seen for the last 30 years. Most particularly, I think we're actually looking at a period when the pattern of the markets could change very fundamentally. Many of you will have seen this chart before. This is the 10-year bond yield. As you know, 30 years ago, inflation was quite high. What we've seen over the last 30 years is we've seen a surge of low-cost goods come into the UK and around the world. And though domestic prices continue to increase, the cost of your lodgings, rental increases to continue to come through, the cost of domestic services continue to increase. They've been offset by lower costs of imports. And that's meant that inflation hasn't really gone forward for the last 30 years. So from the point of view of the stock market, what has been very interesting is if you bought a 30-year bond, maybe 30 years ago, then effectively you've made a much bigger return because inflation has been much lower than you might have expected. So the real return has been much, much higher. And if anything, that pattern has been even more exaggerated if you bought even more sort of long-dated assets. So if you'd bought a 60-year bond, but not a 30-year bond, then effectively you would have been in a position where you would have made out like a complete bandit over the last 30 years. What's interesting going forward is, of course, with bond yields being ultra low now, is that actually if you were to buy a 30-year bond for your clients going forward, it may be that if inflation takes off, you may lose money for your clients. And certainly over the 30 years, you can't be certain of many things, but you can be fairly certain you'll not make much money in your bond portfolio if you buy a 30-year bond. And if you buy a 60-year bond, the risks are even more significant. So we're at a big turning point here. The last pattern for the last 30 years has been very much buy long duration assets. Going forward, long duration assets are pretty risky. And when we think of long duration assets in the equity market, these are growth stocks, they're unicorns. So on that case, if that's the case, then how does the UK stand up to this kind of pattern change going forward? Well, the nature of the UK stock market is that we've always had assets which are more cash generative. We have a history of generating income and growing income for our clients. Specifically, we tend to have many fewer of the unicorns which they have in the US. And so the UK stock market is a very different pattern to many others. And most particularly, the great advantage of the kind of UK pattern in terms of the companies we invest in is that if you've got surplus cash, then you're in a great position ultimately to generate good and growing income going forward. Effectively, this is a period where you're relatively short duration assets. Going forward, what is interesting is in the past, actually, it's not been always the hare which has outperformed the others. Yes, the hare's done very well over the last 30 years, but actually the fable of the tortoise and the hare actually gives us a certain indication that when you look back at stock market data in the past, effectively, we are looking at long-term returns being generated by actually the overlooked stocks. They tend to outperform on the longer-term basis. Going forward, specifically, the UK also has a very different stock market to many others. It tends to be a plentiful universe, not just of mainstream companies or mid-caps, but actually small quoted companies, as Julian was talking about, micro-caps, the AIM market. These companies are younger businesses, and being younger businesses, they tend to grow more significantly at times when perhaps the world economy isn't growing much. They're less dependent on global growth. They have more independence. They're often their markets are somewhat immature, and they're able to grow when the world's not growing. And it's that ability to grow when the world's not growing. Perhaps we've got increased interest rates because of inflation. Maybe we've got increased tax rates because the governments need to repay debt. Or ultimately, it may be that we actually do see global growth being rather patchy going forward because globalization is coming to an end. And most particularly, we would argue, actually, the UK leads the world in terms of engaging with companies. We've had a long history of dealing with corporate engagement, dealing with conflicts of interest ever since 92 with the Cadbury report. And effectively, that helps the UK fund managers and private investors engage with companies to try and minimise risk. But that could become, again, more important going forward, because what's going to happen is clearly we're going to be in a period where climate change is going to be a big feature. And although there may be sustainable funds, ultimately what we're looking for is for companies actually to invest to reduce their own carbon footprints. And this includes steel companies and concrete companies and such like. So it's most particularly the UK fund management sector leads the world in engaging on climate change. We think this will bring more capital, not just into the UK market, but into the UK fund management sector. So coming back to the original question, you know, the UK is recovering a bit, but is it going to last? Well, if you look back to what happened previously, we all know about this bit here, which is the green line, that the UK has underperformed the US for the last 30 years. But look what happened last time there was inflation, last time there was more political involvement in the stock market, last time there was real uncertainty about interest rates and such like. We saw that the UK, its short duration assets massively outperformed over a 20-year period. We think we may be just starting that period of outperformance right now. And when you look further down the market cap range, yes, this is the index, the UK All Share Index here. This is going back to the 60s and 70s. But you can see in those days, the small quoted companies outperformed. They've outperformed recently, but they outperformed even at times of extreme financial difficulty. You can see the smaller companies outperformed by a substantial degree. The microcaps outperformed by an even greater degree. Today at this conference, you'll be meeting lots of microcaps, which are hopefully in that kind of position. And most particularly, we would argue in that the UK economy itself may be quite similar to many other economies. Its prospects may not be that different. But most particularly, we would argue that the UK stock market is nearly unique in the world. There are very few stock markets which are vibrant in the same way that UK is. There's very few stock markets in the world which are as engaged on climate change. There's very few stock markets which actually have this heritage of generating good and growing cash and surplus cash at a time when it's uncertain in the world. So to summarise and to finish, effectively, we would argue that whilst the UK has underperformed the US for the last 30 years, we think more recently the trends have been more mixed. Most particularly, we think the current positioning is that a lot of clients are carrying relatively correlated risks to all of these patterns which have been there for the last 30 years. And we think that pattern is going to change and clients will change their positioning and investors will change their positioning. And most particularly, we think the scale of uncertainty is reflected in the dividend cuts, which we think could lead to more unsettled stock markets. But in spite of that, we believe the UK has a heritage of delivering not just premium returns, but actually outperforming the US over the long term. When you go back to the 60s and 70s in the past, specifically the UK has a deeper stock market than others. There's lots of smaller microcaps. There's an ability to make money from adding a stock through stock selection. And most particularly, we would argue that the UK is well positioned for the future regarding being a global leader in terms of ESG. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much, Gervais. And you mentioned dividend cuts there. Well, Sam Barton asks our first question of this session. They ask, as companies have reduced their dividend cover, does this mean that they have been underinvesting their operations?
I think what happens is when you get QE, it distorts market prices. And I think there's been a real fear by many companies that they'll be acquired. And I think, unfortunately, that has led to distortion of behavior. So coming back to your specific question, you could argue companies have been putting up dividends partly to remain independent and try and avoid being taken over. And that in a way, they're investing less in the future. They're buying in their own shares or paying more dividends to their current shareholders. So I think you might argue there has been some misallocated capital there. But actually, what's interesting about the UK stock market as a whole is our heritage is that we can invest over the long term in companies which generate surplus cash. And I think that feature is actually going to be more lasting than the temporary period we've had where dividends were over-distributed.
Okay, so you talk about the companies that generate surplus cash. Trevor Phillips says, great presentation. There you go, the compliments are flooding in. Trevor asks, who are your top three picks on AIM at the moment?
Well, when it comes to picking stocks, I mean, I've got to be a bit careful because we don't want to be promoting companies which have already gone up. So I talk about companies which I think probably haven't moved an awful lot recently. So, for example, I think something like Axis, for example, which is a company which takes softwood and makes it into hardwood. They've recently had a funding which we've supported, which is also one of our larger holdings at the moment. A second example is a company which, again, the share price hasn't gone up. It's gone down recently, and therefore we think it's become more attractive. It's Acrol. It's involved in loo paper. It's a manufacturer of loo paper. It's seen some slightly slower volumes compared with last year. No surprise, really. But we think the cash payback is a very substantial period of cash payback, which we're getting. And we're really interested in companies which generate this very substantial amount of cash payback. And the third may be something like Quadrise. Quadrise is a company which is bringing technology to help the shipping companies of the world reduce their carbon footprint by about 15 or 20%. And there's massive pressure for all these companies to do so. We think the technology which Quadrise is experimenting with a Mediterranean shipping company and others is very exciting. And we're very upbeat about that as well.
So Louis Domeny asks, do we know what drives the UK stock market to outperform in inflationary periods?
Well, coming back to that period which I talked about earlier, which was when the UK outperformed back in the 60s and the 70s, and that was an inflationary period, those companies which have surplus cash not only have the ability to obviously withstand inflation, they don't need emergency rights issues and such like, but most particularly, they can take advantage of the weakness of others to acquire assets from the receiver and make disproportionate return and much enhanced, improve their cash returns going forward. And it's that ability of being listed and taking advantage of the weakness of others and putting extra cash in at a times of distress and buying distressed assets at the wrong price, which I think ultimately leads to extra returns. So coming back to it, I think all assets really, it's not so much how much they're worth on the way up, they're how much they're worth on the way down. And that's all related to the cash they generate. And the UK generates more cash. And those companies which took over, smaller companies which took over other companies back in the 70s, led to extra cash generation and extra dividend growth. That's the cornerstone of why they outperform, in my view.
Gervais Williams, fund manager at Premier Miton. Thank you very much indeed. We've run out of time, unfortunately, but you can see in the chat box that Stuart Forshaw has a very strong point of view about something, but that is to be answered on a different occasion. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Gervais.
Thanks very much indeed.
You're welcome. Right, okay, to our first company presenting today. It's HeiQ, which operates in the textile, chemicals, and to antimicrobial fabrics market, including producing the world's first photocatalytic air sanitizer that created air purifying curtains. It delivered a record performance in 2020. The market cap is 234 million. The chief executive is Carlo. Carlo.
Thank you very much, and thanks for having me. And very happy to present you HeiQ. And I'll go with HeiQ at a glance. I'm one of the two founders. Company started 15 years ago. We were born on a hike in the Swiss Alps. We were kind of our first customers with, on the fifth day, very smelly polyester t-shirts. And our then girlfriend sent us 100 meters ahead. So two scientists, Murray, my co-founder, and I, we used science to solve our problem and created our first technology, a durable odor control technology for polyester t-shirts. We've since grown to be a company of 180 people strong. We're a global company with a lot of R&D hubs and manufacturing sites, a very diverse company with over 20 nationalities and 41% female leadership. And we are, as a company, an innovation powerhouse. We have over six tech platforms. We have 200 innovations that we have brought to market. We have 10 patent families on which we built our successes, and we have been multiply awarded for these technology platforms and innovation. Most important is that we are a company that walks the talk to the end. So we bring technology from the lab to consumers. We differentiate our customers. We do ingredient branding strategies. We have more than 10 ingredient brands. We have over 300 brand partners worldwide. Many of them are Fortune 500 companies, and they are the backbone of our innovation go-to-market strategy. We do materials that cool, that warm, that filter, that repel, that purify. And yes, last year we also did ingredients that stop viruses very quickly on surfaces. And this has been fueling our success in the 2020 year. HeiQ runs a forward integration strategy on key markets. So we are very competent in what are functional ingredients, where we really focus on creating an added value that can be integrated. It can be integrated into functional materials, which when complex, we do ourselves or serve our customers to make them. But we also have ventured into functional finished goods, especially in the medical device field, where we have entered with personal protection equipment, but also in future functional wound dressings that we will inform. We operate in markets that are sizable, antimicrobial textiles, textile chemicals, industrial filtration, and also the probiotic market in which we have entered thanks to an acquisition conducted in the first quarter this year. We run on what we call a proven strategy, and the strategy foresees and sees us to create novel demand. HeiQ is an explorer as a company. We go into new segments, we create new key markets. We really like to be a blue ocean thinking, and come up with our innovations and bring them to market very successfully with brands that enable us to have a very quick market penetration from day one of its go-to-market strategy. We run a very balanced product portfolio where we have exciting growth opportunities, where we are positioned with our blue ocean technologies already in the capability to capture growth in these novel markets that we have created. 2020 was indeed a special year for us. Top line grew 80%. We also managed to add 700 basis points to our gross margin. Equally important is we had over 7,000 media mentions, so more than tripled our brand equity perception, which is a strong driver for the demand going forward for all our functionality, and is also enabling us to capture more and more royalty contracts for our brand equity that we are licensing out. All this has led to a good appreciation since listing on December 7th, and we have clearly managed to grow on the top line, and we have managed to bring new fields in, functional finished goods with 7 million and functional materials with 700,000 that we scored last year, strong drivers of our novel positioning on the market. This 50 million top line yielded us a 14 million EBITDA last year, a 5 million net profit, a very good starting point for the novel year, where we have a cash position of 24 million, which sees us venture out in strategic acquisitions that are capability building this year, and which also sees us more or less debt free in the market. This resulted in a good cash flow 2020, which fuels our capabilities to look ahead. And when we look ahead, then we can take what we built in 2020. We can take a customer base that we have more than doubled. We had 124% growth on invoiced customer. That's a very strong KPI last year. It will take us a few years to fully convert these more than doubling of our customer base and cross-sell our other innovations into it. We've also been able in 2020 to expand the sales network, which is a key effort also for this year. And we managed to enter new markets like medical devices, healthcare, and consumer goods. And we strongly pushed up our brand equity, which is in the long term one of the key assets that the company will have to foster and grow further. We started strong in 2021. The key priority for us this year is to expand our network in Asia. We just finished our full commercial entity in China and are operating there with direct sales now on what is the largest market for our products worldwide. We will build further subsidiaries in South Asia. We will focus a lot on bringing innovations that we created. Like it was mentioned, we created an air purifying technology, HeiQ Fresh Air, used in curtain. It can destroy up to 80% of volatile organic components indoors. That's, for example, formaldehyde, which is carcinogenic, by simply hanging up a curtain behind the window. So we expect big things from this technology, as we expect big things from our other technology platforms that we are running. Important also that we have moved into capability building M&As. We have acquired in March Crizal, which is an industrial biotech company, a company very similar to us, strong IP, a lot of customers, 120 products, and well positioned in complementary markets, which will allow us to take their technology platform, bring it into our customer world, but also take one of their solutions that they have, probiotic surface hygiene, the next generation of microbial management, and bring it to the healthcare sector, which we have started to build up. This acquisition added a sixth technology platform. So you see HeiQ is very rich from the R&D side. We have a lot of capabilities to create innovation that we can then package with our branding and move to market very swiftly. from these platforms, we are operating and creating not only incremental innovations, but also disruptive innovation. For example, the technology platform of our graphene membrane is allowing us to have potentially 1,000 times more permeability than any membrane that is existing today on the market. And this would completely revolutionize batteries, desalinization, dialysis, waterproof, breathable textiles, just as a couple of examples. This is in proof of concept. We are scaling up to go to a pilot plant. It works well in the lab. Now, this year, we'll see us expand it further and move it to market. We do have multiple substantial growth opportunities as a company this year. The ones that we are looking at most are to face the multi-resistant bacteria issue in hospitals and hospital-acquired infections. This is where the Symbiotic acquisition helps us with a hospital cleaner that has shown to reduce 70% of this problem, a very stunning number and a very good opportunity for us to expand it out there. As mentioned, we are focusing on the air purification with our technologies for textiles. And if we look a little bit more long-term, then with the graphene technology, we're focusing on innovating batteries and desalinization plants where we can expect much higher yield and much higher return. So if I close up quickly and summarize HeiQ in a nutshell, then we are a high-performing growth business. We have a very strong financial base from which we're venturing out, high margins, healthy organic growth. We started growing now also by some strategic capability building acquisitions. We are an innovation powerhouse. We work with six tech platforms, over 20 universities. We're financing 40 PhDs around the world that are working together with the already strong HeiQ R&D team. And we have really multiple growth opportunities in the near term and in the medium term. And this is fueling our ambition to grow from what we are today, a 50 million company, to a 300 million company. Thank you very much for your attention. Happy to take some questions.
Thank you. And it all started with smelly hiking t-shirts. Thank you very much for that very fragrant start to your presentation there, Carlo. So the first question is from Alex Simpson. Skin in the game, he asks, what percentage and value does the management team hold in the stock of the company?
Almost 24%. So we're very engaged. It's really not only your money, it's also our money. And we have big ambitions with the technologies that we have created. We really want to use them for the greater good to make more sustainable, more performing products. And we see a big opportunity for us in the current market setting to make that happen. Innovation is never easy, but we have proven in the past that we can bring it to market.
So you talk there about the technology that you've created. Trevor Phillips says, do you know of any other companies that offer the range of products that you do?
There's very little companies that are capable to offer the full range of innovations in the broadness that we have. Most of them operate on less technology platforms, maybe two. We are running on six. That gives us a lot of capability to diversify our innovation offering. It also, with our business model, gives us a lot of agility to position it in the core markets where we see stronger margins. For example, medical devices, where we can now go in and innovate with the backpack that we have created over the years. So there's little competition, if you want, on the broadness of what we offer, and there's even less competition in the business model because HeiQ is running a pull sales and a pull marketing. So we have actually our technologies developed in co-creation with Fortune 500 brands that then specify it down the value chain, and this allows us to have a good price elasticity discussion with them.
Okay, Siddharth Bhaskar asks, can you please give us an insight into your strategy to acquire Auctus and the life of the organization pre-Auctus, if I'm saying that company name correctly?
Correct. So Auctus was a shell company that was listed. with the intention to do a SPAC. We did what is called a reverse SPAC, which is a tool that allowed us to go onto the stock market very quickly and very efficiently within an existing vehicle that was with a clear purpose on the listing already.
And the final questions from Abby Louise, who says, there's lots going on. What are your capital allocation priorities?
Yeah, so clearly we are focusing on strengthening with what we already have, our sales presence. That's a big effort this year. So you will see us more present, especially in the key markets in Asia as we go forward. But we're also fostering capabilities that we need going forward. Regulatory affairs, for example, is one where we are investing a lot. As we go medical, we have to beef up our permits and the go-to-market strategy entry hurdles. We are also investing a lot in new technology platforms that we are scaling up, like, for example, the graphene membrane, which could be a totally disruptive technology if we can make it to industrial volumes. Lastly, we are building the backbone of the team, which is now a much bigger organization, where we are bringing the corporate capabilities to run a global show with a team of other performers that we have put together.
A global show. Thank you very much indeed, Carlo. Centonze, the Chief Executive of HeiQ, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And thank you to all those wonderful questions that you are fielding. Keep them coming in. Our next company is Eden Research. It's the only UK listed company focused on biopesticides for sustainable agriculture. The market cap is £49 million. And Sean Smith is the Chief Executive. Sean.
Good morning, Sarah. Good morning, everybody. And thanks for the opportunity to present Eden this morning. As Sarah mentioned, we are the only AIM-listed company focused on biopesticides and in particular sustainable chemistry for sustainable agriculture. As you see here by the numbers, Eden is a company with strong expertise in intellectual property in plant-derived active ingredients and plastic-free delivery technology, and we'll get into the details of what that means in a moment. We operate in a very highly regulated industry, in particular if our focus is crop protection. This is an extremely highly regulated industry. And so as such, key assets for us are product registrations, not just patents that differentiate us, but actually our portfolio of product registrations, and indeed it's these that unlock the door for us for future commercial growth. Critically for us, over the course of the last year and a bit, we were successful in a fundraise that completed just before the first lockdown, in which case we raised £10.4 million gross. And this has enabled us to further develop our business over the course of the last year and a bit. And of course, it provides fuel for future growth as well. The unifying factor in what we're doing and all of our product developments that we're targeting across three broad industries, those being crop protection, animal health, and consumer products, is that we're developing products that are based upon plant-derived active ingredients that are packaged up and delivered using a clever technology that in and of itself has been derived from a natural source, that being yeast extract. So it allows us to formulate products that are not just sustainable in the chemistry, but also in the delivery systems. Our product focus is very much based around the combination of three different registered active ingredients. And these are active ingredients that we have registered in multiple countries for use in crop protection products, and also under the biocidal products regulation in the EU. Our products are biologically active. They help us to tackle problems in not just consumer products and animal health, but in particular in crop protection, where we are targeting a wider range of fungal pathogens as well as parasites. Increasingly, we're focusing our efforts on the development of new insecticides and also seed treatments, which we'll talk about a little bit later. The common denominator across all of the products that we're developing at the moment is that they have very favorable environmental and health profiles. That is partially based on the fact that they are derived from plants themselves, and in fact they make up what can be considered a part of a plant's immune system. These products all fit the profile and the direction of regulatory travel, which of course is actually driven by consumer sentiment and government concerns over health, safety, and the environment. We give a couple of illustrations here of how our products are used, and first we begin with the context. The context being that there is a very strong drive today towards sustainable agriculture. And what is this driven by? Well, primarily consumer concerns and government concerns over pesticide residues, for example, in our food, pesticides being found in places like ice caps, pesticides being found in populations that have never been exposed to such pesticides. And, you know, what does that mean? Well, it doesn't mean that we can get away from the use of pesticides entirely, because, of course, the world isn't getting any less crowded and people aren't becoming any less hungry. We still have a need for efficient, effective agriculture. And as such, what, you know, the global producers of our food require is products that are safe and also effective. So there isn't effectively a tax on the growth of high-value crops, for example. Some examples of characteristics that our products deliver to farmers is that we are residue-free. In other words, we're not subjected to maximum residue limits. Our product formulations are solvent-free. They're based on plant-derived chemistry, as I mentioned earlier. And for example, we have low or no pre-harvest intervals. This gives farmers the ability to use our products right up to the point of harvest, where the crops have had the most investment and, of course, have the greatest value. You see across the bottom a number of different organizations that have certified our products as meeting organic standards. Our active ingredients are allowed in the EU for organic agriculture. And while organic production only represents about 10% of global agriculture as a whole, it is one of the fastest growing areas. And what's interesting and a real differentiator for us is that we're not really competing with other organic products. We're competing with conventional chemistry, delivering the same kind of efficacy that conventional chemistry provides growers, whilst at the same time meeting the demanding standards for organic production. A couple of illustrations of the type of diseases that our products or pests that our products are targeting. This example is botrytis, and I recognize very much that botrytis isn't a household name, but it is for us. But you can see sort of the impact that diseases such as botrytis have on crops. For example, botrytis can cause a yield loss of actually over 50% for growers that encounter it during the growing season. You can see what impact that would ultimately have, for example, for a farmer. Our products compete in the botryticide market head-to-head with conventional chemistry, and we've been very successful in growing our market share over the past few years in which our product has been authorized for sale in Europe. Our second product is a product that's been commercialized more or less globally by Eastman Chemical. They're focusing on 30 different countries globally. Here, this product uses the same delivery technology, the same active ingredients, and is focused on plant parasites called nematodes, which affect a very broad range of crops globally. Next, we'll just talk a little bit about our delivery technology, which we've branded as Sustain. Now, Sustain is a microencapsulation technology. What does that mean? Well, the best way to think about that is it's a delivery technology for active ingredients that are used in a formulation. And what this technology does is it helps enable our products to be more effective and safer in use, and it provides them with good, stable shelf lives. An alternative to using our microencapsulation technology, and in fact, the most broad approach to microencapsulation in industry, is actually the use of polymers in these formulations. And of course, with the increasing focus on microplastics in the environment, we're very pleased to be able to offer the industry, not just ourselves, the use of this technology to more safely and effectively deliver active ingredients without the use of microplastics. So what are we working on at the moment? I mean, key for us is with two products in the market, we're very focused on diversification. This means new product authorizations, it means new territories, and it means, in fact, new products being introduced or going through the development process. We've been very focused on research, development, and operations. The fundraise that we completed a bit more than a year ago has allowed us to develop a strong in-house capability, growing over the last couple of years from a team of two people to a team of over 15 now, focused primarily on R&D, regulatory compliance, regulatory or product registration, and ultimately commercialization of those products. Our commercial footprint is very much linked to our regulatory footprint. So the countries that you see here for our first and second products are the countries in which we have authorization and in which we have distribution relationships. So as that list of countries grows, most notably, for example, in the US and in Asia, we'll see our commercial footprint grow commensurately. So what's the opportunity in global biopesticides? And what is a biopesticide? Very quickly, a biopesticide is a pesticide that has been developed from a biological source. So that can be the use of microbes, it can be the use of plant-derived active ingredients, which is the case for us. Biopesticides is still a fairly small percentage overall of the global pesticides industry, which is about $75 billion a year, but it is the fastest growing segment. Talk very briefly about our capabilities. We've, during the course of the last year, expanded our R&D capabilities, which allows us to control our own destiny, to control costs, and to shorten the development cycle for our products. And critically, I wanted to speak briefly here about an agreement that we just announced about a month ago with Corteva. So if you don't know Corteva, that was the entity that emerged from the merger of Dow Chemical and DuPont when they merged their agricultural assets. They are the global leading pure play in crop inputs, and they are a critical player in both pesticides as well as seed treatment chemicals. Our arrangement with Corteva sees the development of a new seed treatment product that we're targeting to launch as quickly as possible, frankly, but we're targeting the 2024 growing year, all subject to regulatory approvals. What is a seed treatment? Well, this is a new area for us, and seed treatments are basically, you can think of them as coatings on seeds that help to give the most expensive agricultural input the best start it can get in life. And this agreement sees us having agreed commercial terms with Corteva and a development pathway that will see the product launched into the market as quickly as possible. You can see that seed treatments themselves are a very significant market with 6.5 billion US annually. The industry is also growing significantly at between 10 and 12% per year. Okay. I think we'll wrap up by just making a couple of quick points, which again is to remind everyone that Eden is AIM's only listed company focused on biopesticides. We are growing significantly. We've enhanced our internal development capabilities and therefore have shortened our development cycles. And we are very much focused on going to market in partnership with global industry leaders such as Corteva, as well as a range of selected regional and national partners. And with that said, we'll wrap up.
Thank you very much, Sean. Botrytis, there you go, something I've learned today. So you talk about conventional chemistry. Barry Hatch asks, what is the cost of your products compared with conventional pesticides?
Yeah, two points, and it's a great question. First of all, one of the points behind biopesticides is that they should be faster to market and lower cost to develop. And here we're talking about a fraction of the development of conventional chemistry. And the regulatory landscape for products such as ours is actually becoming, generally speaking, more simple. In other words, regulators globally are recognizing the need for this type of product and making the registration pathway a bit shorter. However, I think the intent of the question is actually to ask, how do we compete in the field? In other words, do our products cost more for a farmer? And the answer, quite simply, is no. What we know very much is that farmers are very reluctant to put their hands in their pockets to spend money on things that they don't perceive that they need. And as a consequence, unless they're told that they have no choice, and that is increasingly the case, farmers really don't look to pay a premium for products. They look for performance, they look for efficacy, they don't look to pay a premium. And as such, our products are priced accordingly.
Okay, you talked about competition there. You know, both you and I have said you're the only UK listed company focused on biopesticides, but Trevor Phillips says, are your listed peers valued on similar multiples to Eden Research? Are there any peers?
Well, it's very difficult to pick that one apart. I would say that another company that comes to mind has a very similar market capitalization to Eden, and this is a company called Plant Healthcare. Plant Healthcare and Eden are somewhat different in the sense that we're both focused very much on sustainable agriculture. Plant Healthcare's focus is very much more in the biostimulant section, whereas our focus is very much on the biopesticides section. So it's a little bit like the difference between treating disease and creating healthier plants, and that's how we would differentiate ourselves in a simple sense.
Okay, Jackie Matthews asks, are you looking to get full regulatory approval for your animal parasiticides? If so, what is your estimated time to market for those targets?
Well, yeah, to be clear, we're not focused on the development of treatments for parasites. I'm not even going to try to say parasiticides. But we're not focused on that at the moment. Our products for animal health at the moment treat dermatological disease, in particular in companion animals. And initially, the product focus is very much around dogs. And yes, I mean, there are cases where products such as that are regulated. At the moment, the product development pathway being taken by Elanco, who's our partner in this particular area, is focused on products that are distributed through the veterinary medical distribution channel in North America, and in particular with a focus on the US. That doesn't require particularly robust regulatory clearance, but it does require supported claims.
Okay, we'll end on an agricultural metaphor. Atul Unat Kat says, is Eden ripe for a takeover?
Well, I guess that's a difficult one to answer, isn't it? Our focus is very much on building value for our shareholders. And what does that mean? That means we continue to develop the business along the pathway that we've been on for the last few years, developing more and new effective products, targeting a broader range of market opportunities, for example, with the insecticide and with the seed treatment products. And as such, along that path, if we become an attractive acquisition candidate, so be it. But the focus is very much around building value in the company.
Lovely. Sean Smith, Chief Executive of Eden Research. Much obliged. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Thank you for those questions. Sorry if I'm not getting through all of them. Let's get on to our next company now. IXICO, four major contract wins in the last 6 months, a collaboration with Microsoft, and the news is flowing from IXICO. Nice little uptick in the share price this morning. The market cap is £45 million. The Chief Financial Officer is Grant Nash.
Hello, good morning, everyone. Thank you, Sarah, and I'm delighted to be able to present IXICO to you today. But just before I do, I wanted to highlight the exciting news on aducanumab, Biogen's Alzheimer's drug that is making headlines around the world this morning. Yesterday afternoon, the FDA announced that it was giving approval for aducanumab, subject to some conditions. What this means is that for the first time in 18 years, a drug will become available to address this terrible disease. This news is significant for the AD community, which has had to suffer so many drug failures over the last few years. But irrespective of its approval, aducanumab is splitting scientific opinion. This is because questions remain around its efficacy. It's got known side effects, and it is likely to be expensive to deliver. This is nonetheless undoubtedly very big news for the AD community, both in terms of there being an available drug on the market, but it's important the likely traction this is going to create in the search for more efficacious AD drugs, with the FDA now having set a precedent for what is required to approve a drug in this difficult to address disease. So across the globe, it was estimated in 2015, there were approximately 50 million people living with dementia, of which AD is the largest cause. And this is expected to increase to approximately 130 million by 2050, as population ages and other diseases, such as cancers and heart disease, continue to see enhanced treatments. The approval of Biogen's aducanumab is therefore not only significant news for the AD community and Biogen, but it's also significant in news for investment in CNS as a whole. The FDA's approval suggests pharma companies will focus increasingly on biomarker data within neurological indications. This is important for IXICO as we are a company specializing in the analysis of neurological biomarkers. And we see this approval as an important milestone in encouraging wider investment in CNS drug development and the acceleration of finding a way to slow down, halt, and ultimately cure this terrible disease. So just turning on to my slide three. For those of you not familiar with IXICO, I'll start with an introduction to what we do as a company and why. IXICO is a data analytics specialist focusing on supporting clinical trials in the CNS drug development space. As a company, we were founded in 2004 as a spin-out of a collaboration between Imperial College, King's College, and UCL. To be clear, we don't develop drugs. We provide specialist imaging and digital wearable data analysis services using algorithms developed over the past 15 years. What we mean by this is by using artificial intelligence and access to disease-relevant data, for example, brain MRI scans of individuals with specific neurological diseases, we've developed analysis tools that allow us to identify small changes in biomarkers, which have been shown to reflect the progression of that disease, and therefore can be used to determine the safety and efficacy of a drug candidate in a clinical trial. As you can see from the slide, which shows segmentation of the brain using a proprietary LEAP algorithm, we're able to analyze biomarkers in disease areas such as Alzheimer's disease, Huntington's disease, Parkinson's disease, Friedreich's ataxia, and other rare neurological conditions. We support global pharmaceutical companies and biotechs using a centralized remote service model to provide clinically meaningful information on drug safety, drug efficacy, and on patient stratification, i.e. whether the patients being recruited for a CNS trial show the biomarkers reflective of the disease or stage of the disease that a trial is seeking to address. By providing objective measures of biomarkers, our purpose is to increase the reliability of data used within clinical trials. This means we improve the ability of our clients to assess their drug candidates, increasing the opportunities for trial success and potentially reducing costs of those trials. We're a profitable technology company with revenues of 9.5 million to September 20, which was our last financial year end, an EBITDA of 1.3 million, which is a 14% EBITDA margin. And we have a strong order book of contracts that provide good visibility of future revenues. And we estimate that we currently hold less than 10% of the market share. So there's plenty of room for growth doing what we do today. To provide a little more detail on the market opportunity and how we address this, this slide shows in the top half the drivers of the CNS clinical trials market. An aging population combined with significant scientific breakthroughs over the last few years is encouraging an increase in investment by global pharma in developing drug candidates that utilize novel approaches to neurological disease modification. We also believe that today's news on Biogen's AD drug will only accelerate the market growth. This is further fueled by global initiatives, both public sector and charity-led, that encourage the leveraging of advances in genetic understanding to address rare diseases, many of which are neurological, thereby providing an attractive market for the CNS investor. When you add to this the acceleration created by COVID-19 of the need to move to more objective measures in clinical trials that can be operated remotely, then this provides further strong opportunities for companies like IXICO, which already operate to a remote-based model. The development of algorithms that measure disease biomarkers enables earlier intervention in disease progression. This is by using imaging and other modalities to measure specific biomarkers in an individual who may not yet be showing physical symptoms of the disease. In being able to do so, drugs can be trialled against the disease much earlier in its progression, often many years earlier, thereby potentially increasing the likelihood of drug success. IXICO is well placed to benefit from all of these drivers of investment in CNS by pharma and biotech companies. By developing our analytical capabilities internally, and also in collaboration with others, primarily key opinion leaders and academic centres, as well as our pharmaceutical clients, IXICO has been able to improve the algorithms by training them on data sets specific to individuals with the disease. This is something we have been doing for over a decade, and so whilst artificial intelligence itself is not a significant barrier to competitive entry, the training of that AI on such highly contextualized data sets very much is. We're further developing our offering both by investing in our AI platform and the platform we use to capture and analyze trial data. We believe these investments enable us to respond to the growth opportunity we see over the medium and long term. So, moving on to the strategy that we've been following as a company over the last 4 years since our CEO, Giulio Cironi, joined the company. This is that, firstly, we're working with our clients to provide best possible service to run multiple trials across multiple phases and multiple neurological indications. Secondly, we're cementing our position as a CNS specialist diversifying into rarer diseases such as Huntington's disease, Friedreich's ataxia, and others. In other words, we're winning more trials in more CNS indications. Thirdly, we're targeting more contract wins in earlier phases of trials, phase one and two, and then following those drug candidates as they progress, if efficacious, into phase three. Fourthly, we're focusing on innovation. We're investing in AI and data analysis, and we're responding to the continual development in the CNS clinical trial imaging and digital wearable markets. And finally, our fifth pillar of a strategy is M&A. We have actually completed no M&A over the last 4 years, with our focus being on organic growth opportunity. And that approach has served us very well, and we've seen rapid revenue growth across that period. But looking forward, to support our continued growth and reflecting on the fact that we've built a more substantial market capital position, we now see M&A as an important part of our growth plans over the next few years. Turning now to the numbers, on the top half of this slide, we show the positive development of our revenues, gross margin, EBITDA over the last four full financial years. The revenue graph at the top left shows the rapid growth we have experienced across the period, and we've been able to further augment this in the first half of our current financial year, where we reported 8% revenue growth from the same period last year, despite the significant drag of on CNS trial startup times created by COVID-19. As you can see from the graph in the top middle, we've delivered this growth without sacrificing gross margin. Indeed, our margins have been strengthened across the period into the high 60%. This has benefited from a successful signing and delivery of phase three trials, which benefit from a relatively high proportion of high value, high margin data analytics. This position will therefore vary depending on the constituent makeup of our order book between early and later stage trials. We've also moved the company rapidly to profitability across the last 4 years and further enhanced our EBITDA margin in the last 6 months of this year to 18% of revenues. Underpinning all this, as shown in the bottom half of the slide, we have a strong balance sheet, which has shown net asset growth of 15% in the last 6 months and reported a debt-free, cash-free balance of 7 million at the end of March this year. When considering we also hold an order book of contracted orders valued at 19 million and the market opportunity I outlined earlier, we believe we're very well positioned to grow across the medium and long terms. So finally, to move to my final slide, and I can see Sarah is online. I'd just like to direct you to our recent half-year results presentation, which we gave to the market at the end of May. It can be found under the Investors Investor Info Investor Videos section on our website. We go into more detail than I'm able to in today's time slot, so I encourage you to view that video if you're interested in investing in us. But as a summary, we're a growth company addressing the CNS market, which is being driven by increasing clinical need, accelerating scientific discovery and innovation, and breakthroughs in technical capability, now further augmented by the first AG drug approval in 18 years. We've built a more resilient business model across the last few years. We have a very strong order book, and we've won a number of new contracts over the last few months, with our book-to-bill ratio for the first 6 months of this year at just under 2. We're well-financed, debt-free, and able to fund our organic growth plans. We're focused on investing in innovation and technology to ensure we're well-placed to meet existing and prospective customer needs. And we're a management team that looks to the medium and long-term with a passion for our business. Its purpose in converting imaging and digital wearable data into valuable information to support development of drugs to address the terrible diseases associated with the brain. Thank you for listening, and I'd be delighted to take any questions.
Thank you very much. I've actually watched that video and it's pretty joyful. So yes, I do urge everyone who's watching to also watch it. So here you are. You're a company that delivers insights in neuroscience, particularly Alzheimer's. And yesterday's news from the US that it had approved an Alzheimer's drug. It's one of those moments when you remember what you were doing. What were you doing when that news came through?
What was I doing? I was actually in a meeting at the time when the news came through. The email very quickly came through, and obviously get very quickly followed up by a number of press releases and articles on this. So interesting decision, some really interesting consideration the FDA have taken in looking at this. They've asked Biogen to actually run another trial just to really be sure of the efficacy of the drug. But it really exciting news for the AD community, so we were very pleased to see it.
Very good. Right, to questions in the chat room. Stuart Forshaw asked, how much cash in total has the company raised in its history?
That's a good question. So we actually, as a company, we were a private company till 2013. We then took part in a reverse merger into a company which was listed on AIM, a company called Phytopharm, which had a which essentially was a cash shell. So we essentially inherited cash through that raise. We then subsequently to that raised just shy of $5.5 million in 2018. We haven't raised any money since then. We're now cash generative. We generated about just under $1.5 million of operating cash last year, and we have plenty of cash to deliver our organic growth plans.
Okay, because Alex Simpson's digging a little bit deeper. He asks, have you attracted investment from any of the UK listed pharma or biotech investment trusts, and what other institutional investors do you have?
Yeah, no, again, another good question. So no, we don't have, we're not invested by pharma or biotech. We have 60% of our investment base is institutional investors. So we have BGF as our main investor at just under 20%. We then have some VCT investment from Octopus, Gresham House and Amati. And we also have investment, some CIP merchant capital. The balance is then in funds or retail investment.
Okay, another financial question, but you're the right person to answer it. Grant, if you need to raise cash to fund M&A, will you allow private investors to participate in any raise?
Yeah, so again, good question. So I think, as I said, if we were to do M&A and the right opportunity arose and we looked to raise money off the back of that, then absolutely we would be coming out to the market to highlight that. We obviously have very supportive investors, and we think that from the growth that the company has delivered over the last 4 years, they would be interested in taking part if we found the right opportunity, obviously. But yes, there's potentially an opportunity for new investors to come in as part of any raise. But this is all something that we would have to look at the time once we had an opportunity that was tangible and ready to discuss with the market.
And of course, you're still catching your breath after yesterday's news regarding the Alzheimer's drug. Grant Nash, Chief Financial Officer of IXICO, thank you very much indeed for joining us today.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you very much.
Great. Well, to our next company, Directa Plus. It's a producer and supplier of graphene nanoplatelets, based products for use in consumer and industrial markets. Market cap, £83 million. Welcome to the graphene age and welcome to the founder and chief executive, Giulio Cesareo.
Good morning. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I would like really to start this short presentation covering with few words the company and the process. I founded the company 16 years ago in a pub in Cleveland, Ohio, with three Americans over a bottle of beer, with the idea to design a production unit for carbon nanoparticles. The word graphene was not so sexy at that time, able to be at the same time simple, scalable, and sustainable. And we succeed with this objective. The unit that is now located in Italy, in the north part of Italy, between Milan and Como, has all this plus. And the process has been designed to generate value at each step. So we start from natural graphite. We are a top-down process. We are working on intercalated graphite. And then what we did, that is the basic idea in our blocking patent, we super expand natural graphite with plasma, with a special technology, at very, very high temperature. Expansion of natural graphite is not rocket science. It's been well known by a lot of players since the 60s, but they did so at 1000 degrees centigrade. We are super expanding, exposing for a very short time and in a certain kind of turbulence our particle of natural graphite at 10,000 degrees centigrade, which is more or less the temperature of the surface of the sun. Second step, with a very high pressure, we exfoliate. So the key of our process is the fact that we are not using any chemistry at all. We have the ability to adjust the morphology of the particle, so we can define the thickness and the AP dimension in order to fit all the different needs of different potential verticals. The yield is close to 100%, and very, very interesting, because I explain how high is the temperature we are utilizing. There are no defects and there is no oxidation. In the next slide, let me try to drill down on the mission. Our mission is to match what is possible today with graphene with what is needed by industrial partners. We are not a group of sophisticated innovators. We are practitioners, so we adopt the trial and errors approach, and by working in this way, we were able to enter as quick as possible different verticals in a quite effective way. Nowadays, finally, graphene is getting very positive signal from the market, and we analyze more than 10 market research on graphene, and the compound annual growth rate is in the range between +30% and +40%, much better than last year, and is driven this consensus by two major elements. The first one is the demand of antiviral and antibacterial properties, and graphene is able to be very effective in this area. And the second one is the demand of nanoplatelets, because now the attention is on the super additive. Also on Directa side, we are getting a very significant signal. We had an increase in our turnover of 144% last year. And this year, the first 4 months of 2021 versus the first 4 months of 2020 that were record months for us, we see an increase of 49% in our turnover. So we have very high expectations, and these expectations are driven by three pillars. Our ability to define strategic relationship, and I will cover later what we're doing with Nextech, the lithium sulfur USA company we are working with. What we are doing with Iterchimica, our Italian partner developing a new additive for asphalt with our graphene inside. Ital Design in the automotive arena, and Setcar, which is the company we acquired in Romania for the environmental vertical. Very important is the fact that since the foundation, we put sustainability as the backbone of our strategy. And we did so when sustainability was not such an interesting word, and is still, you know, the objective to produce a sustainable material, to work with people that are focused on health and environment. The third point is what we did with the IP. Since the beginning, we invested in a very clear IP strategy. Today, we have 48 granted patents and 25 pending. We have 18 families, 4 covering in a very solid way, in a very aggressive way, our production process, and 14 covering products and application. In the next slide, let me try to make few comments on business development highlights. The major progress we did last year was in the environmental vertical with the acquisition of the Setcar company. We face a very strong contract momentum, and we are performing or even overperforming with a specific project that I will cover in the next few slides. The new application in textile, they've been driven by what we did to recover the market lost because of COVID. We launched our face mask at the beginning with the goal to offer a technology able to transform non-woven material into an acceptable filtrating product. We succeed, but we also discovered that this treatment was adding very strong antibacterial and antiviral properties, and we tested the antiviral properties on SARS-CoV-2 virus very successfully. We did in a Rome hospital using a insulation chamber of category 3, spending significant amount of money, but we have an important paper demonstrating that our material is really able to slow down the life of the virus in a significant way. Last year, despite the crisis of the traditional textile, we were able to sell more meters of printer textile. In this area, instead of selling just the black powder, we move ourselves up in the value chain, and we're selling textile treated with our material. We increase of almost 11% the amount of meters sold. We are quite advanced in terms of what we are doing in the asphalt arena, and I will try to cover with few comments. Lithium sulfur is without any doubt a very high potential opportunity. We are still exploring with our partner, and we are working together on real projects. Growing patent portfolio, as I mentioned already, is significant. We had an increase in the last 2 years of more than 100% in terms of granted patent, and we continuously invest in a proper way in this area. Now, before starting a short video on our product Graphisorber, which is the key product in the environmental arena, let me spend a few words on Graphisorber. Graphisorber.
You only have 30 seconds left. Just okay. To burst your bubble. Thank you.
Okay. Let's go with the video.
And if you turn your microphone back on.
Done. This is self-explanatory of how effective the product is. And let me finish by telling that we are moving in the right direction in all our verticals. We are, of course, moving also in the direction of cash flow break-even in a very short time, and we would like to ask our investor to think at Directa not in terms of what it is and what it does, but in terms of what it knows and what it owns. Our ability to move from one vertical to the other is significant. Our IP is very strong. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. 10 minutes just isn't long enough, but I do agree with you that the best projects originate over a bottle of beer, and look where that's led you now. Now, in terms of key personnel appointments, you've got a new chief financial officer. He'll be taking up his position. Well, he took it up last week, Mr. Giorgio Bonfanti. What is his mandate? What are the main jobs that you've given him to do?
Yes, the mandate of Giorgio is really challenging. Giorgio is spent several years in PwC in merger and acquisition and working with listed companies. Now the goal is to grow the company as quick as possible, to move to EBITDA and cash break-even, but also to sign significant contracts. So Giorgio will work with me in signing contract and in starting a very important licensing activity.
Okay, so you say signing contracts there. Are we going to be getting a pipeline of news about contracts that have been signed?
Yes, you know, the most significant signed contract in the last few months is what we did with Nextech, without any doubt. Nextech is a company working on lithium sulfur batteries. We signed a memorandum of understanding, then we signed a supply agreement for 3 years that can be extended of additional 2 years. And yesterday we announced that Nextech decided to open an Italian company to work close with us, because we have already a joint lab that is active in putting together our graphene with their cathode solution. Second comment on contracts, very quickly, we have in our portfolio so far close to 5 million euro contracts in the environmental arena in Romania.
Okay, Peter D'Souza asks, how long do you think it will take to develop the lithium sulfur battery, roughly?
Well, you know, I hope that this is going to happen pretty soon. No doubt that the latest news on the drastic cost increase of cobalt and all the rare materials will force a lot of players, significant players, to look at the new and different solution. And the advantage of lithium sulfur is that there is just sulfur and graphene inside. I'm talking at the cathode side. It will take a little bit longer to get the certification in the automotive arena, but I expect that in the stationary battery, this could happen really, really soon.
Very good. Our final question. Mark Russell asks, how much of a barrier is the current ECHA reach limits for graphene to meeting growing market demand, especially at the commodity end of the business?
Well, you know, the real entry barrier since the beginning was the fact that graphene has been isolated with a technique that has nothing to do with a significant production system. Now, it took a long time to all the players to capture the attention and to be properly certified by the large supply chain. Finally, the large supply chain realized that there are some of these players with the ability to scale up and produce accordingly to their need. And I expect that graphene will really enter this area in the next couple of years in a significant way.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much indeed for sharing your story and for sharing the video, which I enjoyed in particular. Giulio Cesareo, the Chief Executive of Directa Plus, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you, if I'm not getting everyone's full names spent and said correctly. Okay, well, our next presenter has been described as a visionary entrepreneur with a flair for identifying emerging global trends, one of which is the agrarian revolution. It is Jim Mellon. He's non-executive director of Agronomics, the listed alternative proteins company. It's AIM listed with a market cap of £199 million. Jim.
Well, thank you very much for having me. I'm going to make a couple of predictions, in fact, three predictions before I get into the, I always say the meat of the presentation. That's probably the inappropriate word at the moment, but the main context of the presentation. The first is that I predict that by within 10 years, the dairy industry as we now know it, which is milk and milk-based products coming out of cows, will be gone. Already, the US market for so-called plant-based alternative milks has risen from 0.5% about 10 years ago to somewhere around 1/5 of the market today, with the two biggest milk producers in the United States having gone bust. And the plant-based alternatives, we know, are gaining ground. You probably saw that Oatly went public for a $10 billion valuation in the US. But the really exciting area, I think, is in precision fermentation, which is about to hit the market in the form of milks which are identical to milks coming out of cows, except cows aren't involved, and cheeses, yogurts, and other milk products. So that's the first prediction. No dairy industry within 10 years. Second is that 50% of the meat market as we know it today will be gone in 10 years and will be replaced by plant-based meats, which we're all familiar with, like Beyond and Impossible, corn in the UK and meatless farms, but also by the products of cell ag companies, which is what Agronomics largely focuses on. That will have a dramatic effect and positive effect, in our opinion, on the environmental destruction that the current intensive farming of animals wrecks on the world, and will also be positive for human health and positive for investors in this area. And the last is, of course, fish. We believe that with products coming onto the United States market by the end of this year from cell ag fish, that as much as 50% of the fish market could be disrupted within 10 years and will be replaced by cell aquaculture, as they call it. In other words, the production of fish in laboratories and factories. So those are my three starting predictions. So there is a wave that Agronomics is riding, and it's at the very early stage. We call it the dial-up phase of the internet of this particular industry. Everyone is familiar with plant-based proteins. That's not the real area that we focus on because we don't think there's sufficient intellectual property protection in the plant-based area. So we're focused on cellular agriculture and we're focused on the picks and shovels that go to make cellular agriculture happen. Cell agriculture covers cultivated meats, dairy proteins, and of course, and fish. And materials, and it's probably not widely known that materials are now being grown in laboratory conditions such as leather, cotton, and so forth, and that's a very exciting area. Overall, this whole area is an addressable market of $5 trillion, which is approximately twice the size of the UK economy, and certainly bigger than the electric vehicle industry, which has got so much hype in recent years. We all know, I think, people on this call, that the implications of animal husbandry as it is currently practiced, I'm not talking about artisanal farms or organic farms or anything like that. I'm talking about the way in which 99% of farmed animals are produced in the United States and 90% in Europe. It's a big cause of greenhouse gas emissions. We can argue all day long about what percentage it is, but it's probably the biggest form of man-made emission contributors out of everything, including transport. It's very bad for human health. We're in the middle of a pandemic. If we got a pandemic that was bacterial instead of viral because of the overuse of antibiotics in farmed animals, God help us. And this isn't a joke. 80% of all antibiotics are used in agriculture. We're becoming increasingly resistant to antibiotics. So we need to reduce the inputs of antibiotics into farmed animals. And one of the best things to do is to replace farmed animals with plant-based proteins and with cell ag-produced meats and fish. Animal welfare is a disaster in many ways in many parts of the world. 80 billion animals are slaughtered every year for feeding humans. And of course, there's always the zoonotic disease that I mentioned or alluded to earlier on. We are about to have a complete disruption of the agricultural field, and it's a good disruption. And the companies that Agronomics has invested in are not science fiction projects. They all have products you can either taste or feel. And in some cases, some of these products are already being sold. And in some markets, the food products are already on the market. So this is it's an early stage business. There's not a lot of money that's come into it, but it's accelerating extremely rapidly. And it's something that we do every day, which is to eat. So the market potential is absolutely enormous. And it doesn't go back very far. So the first lab-grown burger was unveiled in London in 2013 by Dr. Mark Post, who's now the chief scientific officer of the our company, Mosa Meats. I say our company, the company we've invested in. It cost approximately $300,000. It's now down to about $9 per patty, which seems quite a lot compared to the patties that you would buy in a supermarket. But the trajectory is one that is consistent with what I've called Moore's Law. Moore's Law is basically a riff off the famous Gordon Moore, law, which was introduced or posited about 50 something years ago in relation to semiconductors and the price coming down and the efficiency going up of semiconductors on a regular basis. The same thing is happening with cellular agriculture. The price of the inputs is coming up, down, partly due to scientific improvements and partly due to the scale up of the products. And very soon, and I mean within 5 years, we're going to reach what I call griddle parity, which is another riff off grid parity from the electricity industry, in this industry where the price of cell ag products will come down to the price of conventional food products. And that's going to be a great big tipping point. In a nutshell, the overview of cellular agriculture, for those who aren't familiar with it, you take a biopsy sample from whatever species you want, and the best in the species. You extract the stem cells, which are the precursor cells. You proliferate those stem cells using growth factors and bathe them in nutrients, which are roughly equivalent to what the animal would eat in its feedlot or wherever it's being fed. And then you differentiate those stem cells. It's a biotech process. There's no GM involved. And you differentiate them into the key components that you want, which are typically muscle and fat. And then you re-agglomerate them and you have your product. And so it's a relatively simple technology, difficult to execute, but nonetheless relatively simple in concept. And it's one that's been around for many years. And the reason that we got into it is we've been involved in biotech for a long time. This is a biotech process and I understand it. And so a couple of years ago when we set up Agronomics, this was something relatively close to our hearts. And also we are very motivated to change the climate and also to reduce animal cruelty. The timeline is extremely fast. Blue Nalu, which is the seafood company based in San Diego, California, should be on the market with its product by the end of the year. Eat Just has got the first cultivated chicken on the market and approved for sale in Singapore, which is a forward-thinking nation in respect of this sort of stuff. And Supermeat has its product, the chicken, in Israel, and it's not for sale, but it's being tasted in Israel at the moment. And we're going to see a swathe of these products coming to market. Vitro Labs is already selling its leather to the biggest fashion companies in the world as an example. As yet, not a huge amount of money has come in, but it is growing extremely quickly. We are the largest cell agriculture, that is Agronomics, the largest cell agriculture company in the world. It's a bit like being an admiral in the Swiss Navy at the moment, but the Navy is going to expand as the opportunities expand. The valuations of these companies are nothing like the valuations that we see on other tech companies. They're still relatively low. We don't know exactly in some cases what their valuations are, but we think that Memphis Meats, one of the biggest companies, is about $450 million, and Good Meat or Eat Just is about $1.2 billion. So nothing too excessive. In terms of Agronomics, we've just done a raising thanks to Cenkos and others. We have about £63 million in cash. We have a diversified portfolio. We're also very interested in licensing deals, and we'll be looking at that very closely in the relatively near future. We're looking at white space opportunities, in other words, areas that we see that haven't yet been addressed by entrepreneurs, where we can have a bigger stake in the relevant companies. And we're very interested in carbon credits, which will provide a price umbrella for alternative protein companies in the coming years. And we want to be involved in that on behalf of Agronomics. In terms of regulation, most countries are opening up to the possibilities of this. And although there is some resistance, particularly in the United States, we don't expect it to be a big barrier to adoption. And furthermore, a lot of studies have indicated that we are going to have consumer acceptance, particularly in the younger cohorts, in the early days, so that there's a massive opportunity for the companies that Agronomics has invested in to do extremely well. I believe that a lot of these companies will be acquired, rather like biotech companies are acquired by Big Pharma. So we should have some considerable upside in our portfolio. I also think there are some great ideas beyond what we've already invested in, for instance, in pet food and infant formula, which is a huge market. In picks and shovels, as I mentioned earlier, on the bioreactors, the nutrients that go to feed the stem cells that produce the meats and materials, and of course the growth hormones, which at the moment are the most expensive component. And then ultimately there'll be opportunities in structured meat. At the moment we're just going for the unstructured or ground beef market, which is the largest market. In summary, my book, Moose Law, All Profits to Charity, covers the cell ag industry as it was at the end of last year. So nothing, it's changed, but not dramatically. We believe that this is a really good thing for humanity, good for the planet, and we want to remain a leading player in terms of leading rounds, encouraging companies, and developing, particularly in the United Kingdom, some homegrown opportunities in this amazing field. And my colleagues, led by Anthony Chow, are doing an absolutely brilliant job of deploying the significant institutional capital that we've raised in the relatively recent past. So with that, thank you very much. And I guess I'll hand over to questions.
Yeah, we've only got 2 minutes left for questions, but I do hope you are going to sign those books, particularly if they're going for charity.
Of course. Okay.
Sam Morland asks, how long will it take to invest the £65 million raised? Do you expect to make more investments or write large tickets?
That's a great question. I think a combination of the two. We will be doing more investments. And we will also be following on in some of the companies that we really like, as opposed to just like, but we have some that are our favorites, obviously. And we'll be leading some rounds. We expect to be investing all of this money, we think, in around 9 months.
Lisa Gordon asks, what is the regulatory backdrop and how does it differ between your major markets?
It does differ. I mean, countries that are food insecure, like the UAE, or Singapore, where they have to import most of their foods, obviously have a very strong incentive to encourage the development of cellular agriculture. So they're moving faster. But we do think that in Europe, the permissions for sale of these products will occur within the next 2 years. And we think in the United States, meat will be on the market within 2 years. But fish will be on the market by the end of this year because it has a single regulator, which is the FDA, as opposed to the USDA and FDA in the case of meat. So it's going to happen very quickly, a blink of an eye in terms of human development.
Simon Rowan asks, does cell ag meat have a longer shelf life than animal meat? Is it likely to be hygienically safer because if, for example, blood is not part of the process in growing cell meat?
It's a very good question. The answer is yes, it does, because it doesn't have bacteria like regular meat does. And 1 in 6 Americans has to seek emergency medical treatment a year because of the fecal contamination or contamination of the meats and foods that they eat. So this will have none of that, have no antibiotics, no hormones, no bad stuff and any good stuff, and no waste.
Finally, Jim, is one thing is to make predictions. It's another to be an ambassador, a practitioner. So what are you going to have for supper tonight?
We're having vegetable soup. It doesn't sound very exciting, but I'm sure Dafina will make a lovely one. So that's what we're having.
Very good. Jim Mellon, Non-Executive Director of Agronomics. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
There you go. So do buy that book, Moose Law, All Profits Are Going to Charity. Okay, time now, 10:30. And many in our virtual room will know the next company because they might use the PrimaryBid platform. It's the only platform where individuals can join corporate fundraisings on equal terms as institutional investors. It's putting the public back into public markets. James Deal is the Chief Operating Officer.
Many and delighted to be Proactive Investor Forum. A few slides left at the end.
I'm really sorry, but your sound is really bad. It sounds as though you've turned into a robot. So I'm not sure you need to take those out.
Can you hear me now?
Okay, try again.
Hi, James. Can you just refresh the page and then you come out of the room and out?
Okay, so this is the beauty of live virtual conferences. So yes, Moore's Law. So Jim Mellon there talking about Moore's Law and the griddle parity and the fact he's having vegetable soup tonight. And yes, by Moore's Law, all profits are going for charity. So predictions in 10 years time where we won't be drinking milk from cows. Well, hopefully James Deal, the Chief Operating Officer of PrimaryBid, has managed to sort out his sound. So James, tell me what you had for breakfast. Let's see if it's a bit better.
Can you hear me now? Is that working?
Perfect. On you go.
Very good. Thank you. Well, I'll make this even more brief, leaving hopefully a couple of minutes for questions. Thanks very much to the Cenkos and Proactive team for allowing us to co-sponsor this event. So look, PrimaryBid is here to serve the people. There are 5 million individuals in the UK that buy and sell shares on their own accounts, but typically have not been able to access either placings or indeed IPOs where relevant. And PrimaryBid is the solution. We are partnered exclusively with Euronext for 9 countries in Europe and with London Stock Exchange in the UK. We're here to work with the system, with the advisors, the banks, and indeed with issuers to give the people access to company placings on the same terms as the institutions. So we connect issuers now. We don't just talk about retail investors. We talk about the community around the company. So that's employees, customers, investors through intermediaries, and of course, the broader public wherever possible, trying to max out access to the broadest base of stakeholders and shareholders on any given transaction. To date, we've run transactions from across the high end of the FTSE 100 all the way down to the low end of AIM and the main market. Compass Group was the first FTSE 100 ever to include a retail offer as part of its accelerated placing last year. And we've been on almost every FTSE 100 placing since then, as well as plenty of others through the FTSE 250 and below. Taylor Wimpey was the first company to run an employee offer in a similar vein. And this stakeholder inclusion is something that we believe is here to stay for every good reason from a governance point of view, which I'll come on to at the end. Interestingly, I just want to mention the investment trust market, because investment trusts represent best-in-class portfolios of businesses in a lot of cases, or investments that otherwise are not available to public investors in liquid and regulated form. And what we found is increasingly investment trusts are using us again and again, because we're helping them build that level of liquidity from the right source of investors who buy and hold and are there to provide both liquidity and price discovery. And in investment trust world, that's all about staying above the NAV. And if you look at our platform today, we're live currently with the Polar Capital Global Financials Fund and indeed Cordiant Digital Infrastructure as two examples of exactly that. So we pool demand from two sources, both direct via our web and app-based solution, which hopefully some of you are very familiar with, and indeed indirectly through a network of brokers and wealth managers across the UK. We've got almost waterfront coverage with every single advisor and execution-only broker across the UK market. And we are happy to see demand come in from either channel. It's up to the investor to choose wherever they see as the most appropriate source of their capital. How does it work? Well, we've got over 200,000 investors directly now on our platform, and you can download PrimaryBid from the App Store. If you see the QR code there, please do take that as a way in to download the app. We give you access via a push notification or email to both IPOs and indeed company fundraisings. And you can apply immediately via debit card, direct via the app, or as I say, from your ISO or your SIP through your broker. We pool the demand on the same terms and at the same time as the institutional capital and represent the individual in any given fundraising. And this allows you to then maintain connectivity with the company post the transaction. And that's a very important point. So as PrimaryBid, we're fixated on making sure that the message gets through to the broadest base of investors and shareholders possible. We work hard at curating unique content in terms of flyers, videos, and any form of marketing that helps push the right message into the hands of the investor, and indeed to maintain that connectivity between the investor and the company post the transaction, what we term continuing the conversation. Interestingly, this is, as I say, from a governance point of view, gathering attention. So this is all about giving the broadest base of shareholders access to the transaction. And as mentioned previously earlier, increasingly it's companies seeking to enfranchise their employees and their customers in a similar way. And the final slide from me is to say that we are 10% owned by London Stock Exchange now, and their Sparks platform is a very useful window on company data. So we help them produce the right pages for each company that's quoted in the market to give the individual investor full information and a useful window to source whatever data may be relevant for the transaction or any time around that. And with that, I'm happy to hand over to questions.
Thank you very much. Well, let's go from windows to screens, because Bruce Jemison's first question is, when will I be able to use PrimaryBid on my laptop? Currently, it only works on my mobile phone.
It's a great question. At the moment, we are working with an app-only solution in the UK. We were web and app-based, and we will get back there again. So please bear with us. We are just upgrading our web-based solution. What you can do is download all information on a transaction to your screen, but the transaction part at the moment is only app-based. We've been working with different payment providers, and it's coming soon is the simple answer I can give you.
Okay, and in terms of the business model, Mark Proudfoot asks, are PrimaryBid allocations scaled back more than other broker allocations?
So we take as much information from the individual as possible, really to be able to give the company full information to make the right decisions on allocation. What does that mean? Well, as with every shareholder, there's a first step around preemption. So if you're an existing shareholder, we are here to make sure that you get your entitlement in terms of your pro rata amount of shares. Beyond that, we seek to maintain the fairest allocation policy possible. And that again is why we connect directly with the company. So we work with the brokers, but equally it's the company who decides today who should be allocated shares. And we give them full information to make sure that you as the individual get the best representation you possibly can, and therefore a fair treatment in terms of allocation. Certainly in inequality with, as I say, the institutional book.
Okay, here's quite a high level one from Dominic Hughes. Are you able to use aggregated retail demand to influence price, or does the retail investor remain a price taker?
Yeah, great question. To all intents and purposes, we are a price taker as a platform. So all demand that we build is at strike. So there's no price sensitivity for the demand that we generate. It's interesting, though, that from the company's perspective, if you've got 10, 20% of the book, whatever it might be, coming from PrimaryBid that is price insensitive, that helps give some pricing power in terms of very healthy, very allocable demand, more so than some of the institutions. But at the end of the day, we don't tend to have any influence on setting the price. That's done by the institutions, and we take place on the same terms once that pricing formation has taken place.
And final question, Peter D'Souza asks, when will PrimaryBid be available for ISAs?
So as I say, you can go to your broker today and place an order into a PrimaryBid transaction from your broker, from your ISA. That can be done, not with all brokers, but with most today. Ultimately, where we are also going, was indicated in one of the prior slides, is we are integrating with the platforms. So you will be able to participate directly from your ISA in electronic form. And that's coming soon. But if your broker does not allow for ISA participation today, then for those that are familiar, there is a process, a BED and ISA process that can be used. But it's obviously, it requires a little bit of extra work and it's not ideal. So it's a great question. It's the holy grail of where we want to get to. So every individual can participate with ease directly from their ISA.
Was the app down yesterday, asks Jay Shah, and why?
We had, I think it was about an hour and a half yesterday morning, where, as is the case in running a technology-based platform, we do rely on third-party providers for security, for payments, and for other factors. And when they have downtime, we are a victim of that. So yesterday morning was an example of that. And we can only ask for investors' patience. What we do today is very good, but it's not perfect, and we're improving all the time. So welcome any feedback from anybody in terms of good experience, but more importantly, where they've had a frustrating experience, because that's the only way we can improve.
Okay, now recently you launched in France, and I'm just wondering which country is next for PrimaryBid?
So we hang off the exchange in any geography we work in. And it's important because of our neutral stance to work with every aspect of the ecosystem or the marketplace that we're in. Our agreement with Euronext is for 9 countries in Europe, and so it's very natural that we look towards the Benelux region, so that's the Netherlands and Belgium, and as two very likely markets we will be going to next, as well as Ireland, not least because of the number of companies that are dual listed between the UK and Ireland. And then beyond that, it's very interesting to consider where you've got English speaking language and rule of law is a natural guide to where we may take the business going forwards.
Okay, Stuart Forshaw, there's loads of questions coming in now. Stuart Forshaw asks, can a regulated individual use PrimaryBid?
We do take orders from what you would term qualified investors, and we recognize the profile of that. And again, that's part of the book of demand that we submit to the company and to the broker. So we're very open book with the demand that we generate. So yes, we will take orders from the spectrum of call it unqualified, unregulated and regulated investors.
Okay, we've got someone who's got quite a grinchy question. It's harking back to the first question that was asked about Windows and mobile phones and laptops. Philip Murphy saying, why are you not allowing people who do not use mobiles from accessing fairly?
Listen, it's a great question. And as I say, this is why we're in a temporary phase at the moment in terms of operating at the moment with an app-only payment solution. The web is available for viewing transaction materials. And to the point of the question, we recognize who our customer base is, and we will be bringing the web-based solution back online as soon as we can.
Now, if you take us to the end slide there, so I think it's what is it, inquiries at primarybid.com. How quickly do emails going to that account get responded to?
So they will be very instant, except for where we've had 3 or 4 transactions on platform at the same time. And even when we've had moments of 120 customer services staff employed, it has taken us, in some cases, a day or two to respond to people. So, you know, we are growing at a rapid pace, and with that comes its own pains, and we are fixated on trying to provide the best possible service and solution we can, but it doesn't come without bumps in the road and hiccups, not least with flow of interest and traffic. So please bear with us. But again, you know, I'm here and with a listening ear to anyone who's got ideas or indeed concerns or bad experiences. You know, we are only as strong as the services that we use around us, for whether it's onboarding or for payments or for all elements of our process. And for that, we can only ask for a little bit of patience. What we do is a very good thing. And of course, it's free to use for the investor. And hopefully, you know, given there's no other solution that matches this, it should be welcome. But as I say, on a given day, it may not be perfect.
Well, I tell you what, thank you for remaining so calm and collected. Your sound wasn't perfect the first time that you attempted to speak to us. However, you persevered. And I'm delighted to tell you that I'm getting private messages saying I've just downloaded it. So there you go. You've been an absolutely brilliant marketeer for the company. James Deal, Chief Operating Officer of PrimaryBid. Thank you very much indeed.
And can I just simply ask, if there are any outstanding questions, then please do send to me afterwards. I'd be happy to respond accordingly to each one personally. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I believe James when he says that. Okay, to our next company now. And Shearwater Group is an award-winning organizational resilience group that provides cybersecurity advisory, managed security services to help assure and secure businesses in a connected global economy. It's AIM listed. The company has a market cap circa £52 million. The chief executive is Phill Higgins. Thank you, Phill.
Good morning, and thank you. And thank you, everybody, for allowing me to present to you today. Just to introduce the Shearwater Group. First of all, the usual disclaimers, but I'd like to add one to this, is that obviously we're in a closed period at the moment. Our fiscal year end was 31st of March. So the numbers that we're showing you today refer to our half-year announcements and what's in the recent announcements on our trading update. To take you into, first of all, the market opportunity. Depending on who you talk to and who you listen to in the press, there's lots of reference out there in terms of the size of the organisation, the size of the market space. And today, I've got a sample of some of those there today, showing the 281 billion market space by 2027. This is all around the global cybersecurity and networking security infrastructure space. As we move more into e-commerce and onto trading platforms, and it presents an opportunity for the bad people to do bad things. And that's why we're in business, is to prevent that. And that's an ever-increasing market space. To introduce who the group is and why we're here, is we are an IT company that specialise in the manufacturing of software, and we also provide advisory services and solutions. And we present that in a way that we are an award-winning organisation resilience group. We provide cybersecurity, advisory, managed security services to help ensure and secure businesses. And that's predominantly where you could see our root cause of what we actually deliver today and the way we're actually building our company. The company's been built from the top down, starting off on the top left there, Chairman David Williams, a prolific entrepreneur, been in the financial side of the industry for all of his working life, built many billion-dollar organisations, former NED of Breeden, former NED and Chairman of Entertainment One. You appreciate it comes with a huge pedigree of quality there. David very early on recognised the opportunities inside the cybersecurity industry, and he brought together the board that you see in front of you. Notably, you can see Robin Southwell there in the middle, former CEO of Airbus UK, Stephen Ball, former head of Lockheed Martin UK, Giles Willits, the former CFO and board member of Entertainment One. And you can see myself there. I came in through an acquisition through Brookhall, but to my right, to my left up there is the main reason, as I say, I joined the company, and I'll come on to that a little bit later on. And also there on the screen, you'll see Paul McFadden, our CFO. But dropping to the bottom of the page there, just a little bit on Marcus Willett. Marcus Willett, some of you may know, he was the deputy head of GCHQ, the first director of cybersecurity, and you appreciate the importance of having someone like that within inside our organisation advising us as we go. And to the side of him is Lord Reed. Worked under Tony Blair for many years. He's been involved in all sorts of governmentary actions and involvement. And what it's allowed us to do is obviously get involved and understand a little bit more of the workings of the government organisation. He's given us great guidance and support along the way. And I will add that this board that we have been very instrumental in the development and growth of our organisation. They also support greatly the individuals who work inside the company. Just moving through as to what does the group look like. So obviously at the top, we've got the group PLC. And if you actually look at the organisation below, we actually divide it into two divisions. We have our software division and our services division. Within inside our software division, we've got our Secure Envoy and our GLA. And there we focus on selling our services and our software through a two-tier distribution model. We sell to distributors who then sell on to resellers who are located globally. We have in excess of 350 resellers, so they're representing our product set internationally. We also sell the product set, obviously, domestically through our UK channels and also our services division on the right of the page. The technologies that we sell, we specialise in the identity access management and data leakage areas. The first thing you do when you log on to any platform, your social media, your work email, whatever it may be, you have to authenticate. We are in that space. We are that first person that helps you with that authentication. We help control who you are, where you can go, and what you can do. We give you the tools and the facility, and that's the space we're moving in. We also have data leakage and data discovery. As we become more compliant and we require more compliant-based identity access and data leakage auditing tools, we actually work inside that space as well. On the other side of the business, we have our service division. Brookhall is where I came from. We also have Exima Consulting and Pentest. First of all, in Pentest, they're our most recent acquisition in April 2019. and we acquired certain assets of Sakama. And the team that we actually brought over are world-renowned for their quality service, their capabilities, and enjoy the luxury of servicing some of the most recognized software houses and technology companies from around the world. The team there have also been fortunate enough to win Capture Flag not only once, but twice. There in the middle, you can see in the consulting, they provide us our professional consulting business and advisory services. Very similar to the Big Four, apart from the resources that we send to the client base would have 10, 15, 20 years experience. And obviously your price point is so much cheaper as well from the Big Four. Brookhall Solutions, they specialize in solution delivery. They only deal with the top shelf technologies. They're not the commodity player. It's very specialist. The projects that they get involved with would be involved in critical infrastructure, and their long-term cost customers, long-term contracts, and with a lot of recurring revenues with them. Collectively, the group there is supported by our shared services, which is a pilot of the business we introduced back in April 2019 to actually help assist and pick up where each of the organization operating companies were needed assistance. So, for example, in there, we will carry our HR, legal, compliance, IT, and marketing, and we'll complement each of the local businesses as and when required. Our services division, just to note there, is they do sell their businesses, their services and products directly through to corporate clients, and they do have these a very rich client base. They're Fortune clients, and I believe I can give you a little bit more detail on that as we go through the presentation. So just having a look at Shearwater at a glance in terms of some of our achievements. Now, these are just some of the awards that across the group we've been fortunate enough to win. First of all, we have some ISOs across the group. We only use those where needed. Not all the parts of the business will require these. So it's on a as a needed basis. We also carry 8 patents currently. These will get refreshed as and when technology moves and changes. And obviously we'll archive the older ones as we have to. We focus around that Fortune 350, Fortune 500 client base, both domestically and internationally. We will trade, and later on I'll be able to show you the rough split as to where our revenues come from. But today, as I say, we're very fortunate enough to actually have multiple awards. Two awards that I am particularly interested in and very proud of is the two Queen's Awards down at the bottom. One for innovation, one for export. These are associated with our secure envoy technology set.
Phil, you've got 1 minute left.
Okay, so very quickly on the history of Shearwater Group, you can see there the timeline as that what we've when we started way back in Jan 2017, and as we come through to the significant part was obviously in March 2020. When actually we turned profit and underlined an EBITDA of 3.4 million. At the moment, as I mentioned, the fiscal 21 numbers we're haven't yet completed the audit, so I can only give you an advisory. It's in excess of 3.6 million. Now the company has got a very strong financial basis. It's it's got the strongest base it's ever had, and now we're actually ready and poised for obviously moving to the next phase of our development, which will be obviously continuing organic growth plus introducing the potential acquisitions throughout the coming 12 months. Just a little bit on our business division and our revenues. You'll see by our revenue split there that our software business is, it contributes a small amount of the revenue, but it's very rich in its margin and its EBITDA. And when you look at the business, it's very balanced, which is very good from our perspective. It's allowed us to weather the recent COVID situation very well, and it allowed us to, when one part of the business suffers as a result of a softening of top line numbers due to restrictions of COVID interaction, it allows the other part of the business to actually stabilize those numbers. We're well distributed throughout our general offering. We focus on large blue chip clients from our service division, and we sell through our global distributors, as I mentioned previously. with a blended recurring revenues of around about 40%. Just to give you a little bit more there on the EBITDA point of note here, we introduced cost selling. We had about half a million of revenues contributed through a cross-selling exercise, and that will continue, and hopefully that will renew and expand during this coming year. Cash conversion is extremely good, in excess of 100%. We're continuously investing inside our technology sector and to move very quickly into that. Our strategy is very simple. It's a buy, focus, grow. We buy companies, we help them develop, and then we look to actually how we can actually increase their growth by improving the efficiencies inside their organization. The strategy is quite simple. The diagram there, we're looking for cash generative profitable companies. We'll buy the right companies. We're not buying any company. We're looking for companies that will contribute to our purpose and where we're going. We're looking for add-ons in software. We're also looking for large customer-based, reseller-based organizations. And as we bring this all together, you'll see that we'll be moving our target space into that top right-hand corner. Most importantly, this is the last slide. So this is one example. Michael Kelly of Gartner has recently stated that Secure Invoice product and roadmap really fits with the predictions that by 2023, the new category of SaaS-delivered converged IAM platforms will be the preferred adoption method for IGA, AM, and PAM over 45% of new AM deployments. This is a huge opportunity for Secure Envoy. Today, the ticks in the boxes are where we're currently delivering a software solution from Secure Envoy. We've added GeoLang to that same platform, and we sell that through directly as an enterprise technology, but we also add it on our SaaS platform. And you can see the opportunities there in PAM, CAS, and IGA is where we're looking for either development of software or we're looking for acquisition. So we're very active in that role at the moment, very active talking to a target list, and hopefully we will be able to bring news on that as we move into the next stage of our strategy. And that comes to the end. And are there any questions?
Thank you. Let's have a look at that penultimate slide again. That was quite a juicy slide. So looking at that there, Mark Spooner asks, current trading, how would you describe it?
Very robust. Second half of the year, we saw a 24% increase on the same time previous year. We did see a slight change in, because of COVID, we saw appliance-based computing replaced with software and subscription-based, and now we're seeing optimism come back through our consulting. We're seeing the engagements, which were paused, now restarting again, and I'm glad to see that utilization rates are on the up, so very encouraging at the moment.
Okay, we've got 40 seconds left. Time for Andrew Bartlett's question, who says, the authentication space seems to be very competitive with companies like Okta making strides in it. Does Shearwater offer something to give them an edge over their rivals?
Yes. So as you can see from these are the skill sets and the qualities, and everyone is acquiring companies or developing their own. Okta are releasing new software themselves, as will we, and as we have done over previous years. A lot of these companies that you see on here, the CyberArts, the Optus, and so forth, they'll be focusing exclusively on those really large clients. Whereas with ourselves, whilst we do have a number of those large clients which we engage with, the sweet spot for us will be on that tier two and tier three market sector. The cost of sale there is blended and it fits with the way we operate through a distribution model of 350 plus resellers.
Fantastic. Well, really good luck with the buy, focus, grow strategy. Phill Higgins, Chief Executive of Shearwater Group, thank you very much indeed for joining us. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Right, time now is 1 minute past 11. It's okay, I can make the time up because it's all in the name. Brickability is one of Britain's largest construction materials distributors. Its most recent update revealed that Brickability expects to report full year revenues and earnings ahead of previous expectations. John Richards is the chairman of Brickability. Come back, John, and speak to us. Put your microphone on, put your video on so I can see you. I saw you a moment ago. There you go.
And the microphone should be on now.
There you go, the stage is yours.
Okay, good morning. As you heard, I'm John Richards. I'm chairman of Brickability. I have been for 3.5 years, and prior to that, I was at Ibstock, the brickmaker, for 30 years and was part of their four-man team in their 2015 IPO. If we turn the page to the next slide, it'll tell you a little bit about the Brickability Group. We're a leading provider of a select range of building materials, and we're categorically not a builder's merchant. A typical builder's merchant will carry a line of maybe 1,200 products. We carry a couple of handfuls of products, but in those areas, we have real expertise. And our core market is to house builders. As you've heard, our group revenue is expected to be 180 million and adjusted EBITDA in excess of 17 million for the 12 months, the 31st of March just passed. We've made 10 bolt-on acquisitions, which is very much our strategy, in the previous 3 years, including a number since IPO, exploring a lot of new acquisitions, which I'll come to in a moment, and working very hard on our growing credentials in the area of ESG. Now, people often ask, and did during our IPO when we were doing our roadshow, why do you exist? Why is Brickability serving both manufacturers and indeed house builders? Well, if we turn to manufacturers first, be they brick makers like Ibstock or Forterra or tile radiator makers like Ismaquina, they don't have the scale of sales forces required to service house building customers. An example I often use is Barrett David Wilson. There are 28 businesses in that public company. Each of those businesses has an MD, a construction director, a build director, chief buyer, junior buyer, etc., etc. So you have literally in one business hundreds of people that need to be regularly seen. You need a lot of boots on the ground to do that. Manufacturers don't have those numbers. We do. We also have the expertise technically that is required by those manufacturers to distribute their products. We pay manufacturers on time, and don't for one moment think that all customers do pay building materials manufacturers on time. They don't, as I know from bitter experience at Ibstock. We do pay on time, and we deliver our promises. If we say we'll take a number of products from a particular factory in particular months during a given year, we do exactly that, which enables those manufacturers to plan their businesses accurately. Moving on to house builders, well, today they have small buying departments. They don't have the manpower to go and select bricks or roof tiles from 6 or 7 different offerings. So, of course, they come to us because we can provide just about everything. We can also give them the technical assistance, the scheduling, the interpretation of drawings that they need. We're a bit of a one-stop shop. We have a lot of buying power, and we're the biggest customer for many of the manufacturers on this page. And we pass some of that buying power on to them, and they like our service. And that service is given in a house building market which is currently very strong. If you take the graph on the top right, UK dwelling starts, you'll note in 2019, just over 200,000. Now that comprises private and public together. Dropped back a bit last year for obvious reasons. And 2021, the forecast is returning to 2019 levels. That's good news for house building. What's equally good news for businesses like us is the graph below, where you'll see that in the quarter one of this year, 32% of all new builds were detached houses. Go back to 2010, that was 17%. And that's important for building materials because a detached house uses broadly 3 times more bricks or roof tiles or windows or doors than does an apartment. So a strong demand, if you look at the graph opposite, a shortage of supply. Brick stocks at manufacturers in GB at the end of last year were 300 million. 300 million is an all-time low. It means 7 weeks of stock. If it's balanced, it is not balanced. And so many products, brick products in GB, are on zero stock, meaning they're on 16, 20 or 24 weeks availability. And roofing tiles, by the way, are even worse. So looking at the graph above, which is about bricks, there's an estimated demand of 2.34 billion bricks being used in GB this year. 1.9 will be GB made, and that's flat out. There is no more. So the other 440 will come from imports. Puts Brickability in a strong position because after Wienerberger, the manufacturer, we are by some margin the largest importer of bricks into this country. We are acquisitive. We promised that we would be at IPO. We've made a number of them since IPO. The strategy we emphasized. There's not time to go through them all, but they're all in line with bolt-ons into our end user market, with one exception: McCann Logistics. It's a haulage firm, specializes in hauling building materials from continental Europe to GB. We bought it in December because we feared delays, problems, customs issues with Brexit. We have had none of those because we bought this company who is expert in these areas. So our importation of roofing products, brick products, etc., goes forward uninterrupted. We also do startups, a ceramic tile startup, which is just making its way, and an architectural facade startup. The pipeline is strong. We're looking at a renewable energy business, doing heat pumps, inverters, car chargers, solar panels, flooring companies to add to our existing flooring business, which both supplies and fits flooring, be it carpets or laminate, etc. We're looking at two more roofing contractors business, because in the roofing area, we both supply the tiles and we fit them, and maybe a brickwork company. Last week, we completed a transformational acquisition, Taylor Maxwell. Taylor Maxwell is Light Brickability, a leading building materials distributor. It's strong in three areas: bricks, timber, and cladding. So it diversifies our product offering significantly, and it has a slightly different customer base, where we're strong with house builders, Taylor Maxwell are strong with contractors. And that means there's less than a 10% customer overlap. And as I say, it takes us into a significant roofing timber position and a much more significant cladding position. As revenues are 252 million, EBITDA are over 10 million pounds. It puts us on track to get towards 500 million pounds of annual revenues in the near term. At IPO, we suggested we could do that in 5 years. We're now getting close to it in less than two, which we're very pleased with. It's an initial consideration of 40 million in cash, 10 million in shares, and the 13 million to make up the 63 million is both deferred and contingent. And with the help of our friends at Cenkos, our fundraise to fund this purchase was a roaring success. This page just shows you, it's a graphic of some of the products that we supply into house, and I won't go into it in any detail because there isn't time, but what I can show you is that these are pro forma financials since the acquisition of Taylor Maxwell. As you can see, it gives a £432 million projected revenue for this year, and 27.4 million adjusted underlying EBITDA. In the bottom right, you'll see that £219 million bricks will be the biggest division, followed by timber, heating, plumbing and joinery, cladding and roofing. So a bigger product mix than we've had before. And with the other acquisitions we have in mind, that 500 million may not be far away by the end of the year, because we're very, very growth oriented. And as I say, both by acquisition and organic growth. So finally, before I pause for breath, our IPO was almost 2 years ago. We told our potential investors that we would grow organically. We told them that we would fund our bolt-on acquisitions from the cash we generated. We told them that we would come back to the market if there was to be a transformational acquisition. We told them we would spend around 40% of our free cash on dividends. And with the guidance of our friends at Cenkos, we have done all of that. We have great confidence in our market. We have great confidence in our business. And we have great confidence that we're going to continue to deliver. Thank you.
Thank you. My goodness. Well, what a couple of years you've had. Now, I actually have read your IPO prospectus, so let me quote some of it back at you. You said the major competitors to the group were the two large UK brick factors, Taylor Maxwell and E.H. Smith. You've bought one. When are you going to buy E.H. Smith?
Well, I think E.H. Smith would be out of reach, and it's only because of the way its ownership is structured. It's actually family owned, and it is owned by a devout Christadelphian family whose reason for being in business is both the traditional reason that we would all be in business, but also from their religious perspective, their Christian perspective, looking after their flock. And there is not a hope that the family would sell it.
Okay, but there's plenty more acquisitions on the horizon.
There's plenty more acquisitions on the horizon, and we want to do much more in heating and plumbing. Very fragmented industry, big opportunities for us. And now that we're into timber, having purchased Taylor Maxwell, you know, the people who make money in timber are the sawmills, the people who form the timber, the people who treat it, and the people who retail it. At the moment, Taylor Maxwell have just wholesaled it. There's not much money in that, but we're going to invest in it, get the right people to do the things that do make the money, and the margins there could be transformed.
And a recent survey by the Builders Merchants Federation was saying that more people are buying timber, particularly as they are now making their own garden furniture.
Well, they will have had the time to do that, I guess, in the last year. But equally, to build on what you've just said, the sales of fencing and decking over the last year have been staggering. And Taylor Maxwell, our acquisition, have a strong position in both decking and fencing. And again, we intend to go to our house builder customers who do buy both of those things when they're producing new homes, particularly detached homes, which is the vogue right now. And we think we have an opportunity to enhance margin and volumes with those customers.
Okay, so none of us could have anticipated COVID, but hopefully, you know, we are exiting lockdown, which takes me to Alex Simpson's question, which is, as we exit lockdown, there is an insatiable demand for building products, as perhaps reflected in your share price. Given that backdrop and your high share price, surely right now is the worst time to invest in Brickility. What do you say to Alex?
Well, if Alex looks at some of the ratios and some of the numbers and then monitors our performance over the next period of time, it may be that we're still trading at a discount to where we should be. And if he refers to shortages of building materials, he's absolutely right. But we have bigger allocations from GB brick makers than anybody else. We have access to more European bricks and roof tiles and tile radiators and doors and windows than anyone else. So we're in a very, very strong position. And with our own, as I said before, transportation business from Europe, not only can we source it, but we can jolly well get it here. And a lot of our competitors will be struggling to do that.
You mentioned Europe there. Brexit, my goodness, we rarely talk about it now, but it's happened. How's that impacted business?
It really hasn't been a big issue for that. We have, when we went into purchasing bricks from Europe, rather than starting it ourselves, we purchased two businesses that were expert at importing building materials from Europe because they had the right people who were multilingual and had been doing it for 20 or 30 years. And they were Crest Brick and Tile and Bespoke Brick. And because they had the contacts, they had the infrastructure, and now, of course, we have our own logistics business to get them here. We have had the wherewithal not to be affected. We've even set up our own business for customs matters. And as well as getting, I mean, if you do that, it costs you about £100 a load to get products, a lorry load from Europe to the UK. We do it ourselves. It costs us less than 30. And we're now outsourcing that to other hauliers. So we've not been affected. And we move on with great confidence with our European imports.
John Richards, you are an exquisite ambassador for your company. I'm glad you're the chairman. So there you go, John Richards, chairman of Brickability. It's been an absolute pleasure. More time next time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you very much to you all for your superb questions. Time now 11:15. And the vision of Rural Life Sciences is to improve the lives of millions of patients by improving and enabling medical devices with Elastion. That's a world's leading long-term implantable polyurethane. The market cap is around about £33 million. And David Richmond is the chief executive. David, over.
Thank you for that introduction, Sarah. Good morning, all. And thank you for Cenkos for the opportunity to introduce your Rural Life Sciences to you this morning. I'd just like to start off with a bit of information on the name, a little story to get everyone warmed up on the Rural Life Sciences. So the word RUA, R-U-A, is pronounced RUA, but is also a Scottish Gaelic word spelt R-U-A-D-H, but phonetically sounds the same. And that Scottish Gaelic word is the word for red. And in my early career, I was in the Merchant Navy and ended up on the west coast of Scotland. And I was known as Davy Rua. So a bit to do with the hair, and I then used that as part of the Rua medical devices, and we're now building that Rua brand. So I joined the board in 2018 in the group, and the group then purchased my business in April the 1st, 2020, and I became the CEO 1 year ago. So that was in diversity in the 1st of April, obviously moving into lockdown. So we've had a very challenging year as a company moving forward, but we've made great progress in that area. The structure of the group. So as Sarah kindly introduces us, we have a platform of an implantable polymer called Elasteon. It's a copolymer of silicon and polyurethane. And that leads to the overall arching group purpose. So we have split the group into four subsidiary companies to oversee all these different the areas that we want to take forward. So the biomaterial, we have Rua Biomaterials, so that's the licensor of the Elasteon copolymer, and we're supplying that into the global medical device industry. Rua Vascular, we're commercializing our own products using the Elasteon and sealed graft soft tissue patches, and Rua Structural Heart, as we're developing and commercializing an Elasteon tri-valve heart valve system. And Rua Medicals, which is the business I sold into the group just over a year ago, is we're a subcontract, end-to-end contract developer, supplying subcontract services to the industry, but also specializing in implantable fabrics, is where I have come from, a long line of textile industries in the past, and based in the Ayrshire Valley in Scotland. So these groups, subsidiary groups, have been set up with the primary to concentrate in specific areas of the Elasteon development. So I'll go through all these four areas in detail, in a bit more detail for you. The Elasteon is a wholly owned technology platform. The group owns all the IP, the technology, and we currently license the manufacture of the material out to a company in the US called Biomerics. So they manufacture the product for us and distribute it and sell it into the global customers through the US and Europe and the Far East, where the product's used. So the main key features for this particular product is that it is clinically proven. So the product's been used in humans for over 15 years, and we have over 7 million long-term implants. So this is the big thing in this industry, where we're looking to replace and use other products within the body. So having that base of clinical knowledge and clinical usability in place for 15 years is a great advantage for us. We do have a range of over 20 patents in different sizes and different areas of the application of Elasteon into products. And I've got a small few pictures there on the right-hand side of some of the products that's currently being used in. The top squiggly things are pacing leads. So that's a long-term implantable, and they've been in people for over 15 years, and with great data, great performance characteristics in the long term within the body. The second picture there is a urinary stent. It's been coated with Elasteon. The stent itself normally would be put in the urinary tract, and a normal uncoated stent would only last up to 3 months and then would have to be replaced. But being enabled by Elasteon, that can last up to 3 years. So much more improvement for the patient. And the two at the bottom there, with an ECMO tube there. So that's a coated tube that's being used to oxygenate, to help take the blood out of the body, reoxygenate it and put it back in again. in COVID-19, that's been very, very popular and used substantially more, so that marketing. And then we've got a rescue stent where an aortic surgeon, if there's a problem with the when inserting a normal stent, if the aortic vessel ruptures, I think you can put this rescue stent in as to help them solve the issues of the patient with a diseased aorta. So I'll move on to the next one. So the neurovascular business is where we've been spending a huge amount of time in the last year developing our platform of products. So we've developed a new technology for the vascular graft market. There's nothing new. There's nothing new has happened in this market for over 40 years. So what we've done using Rua Medical's textile knowledge and using the elastome polymer is to create a sealed graft. So elastome on the outside and the fabric on the inside. The giving the surgeons a much better product to use, but also eliminating what is normally the grafts are normally coated with is a collagen or a gelatin, so it's an animal derived byproduct. What we've done is we're using a 100% Bollersmoe. It's eliminating any animals supply chain issues or cross contamination between species. And there's also the added advantage that there's some religious acceptance of the graft being used in different areas. I always like to give a practical demonstration, but here's one that I prepared before. It's the graft sitting below. So this is an aortic root. This end part gets sewn onto the end of the heart, and this then goes off down the aorta. And what we've managed to do with our proprietary technology is that we've managed to produce the Valsalva bulge here. Normally, this would rely on the blood pressure to open it up, but in this particular instance, we've developed a one piece that can be sewn in by the surgeon or can be put onto a heart valve and put through. So this, as we mentioned, we're in commercialization of this product, and we're in doing it two ways. We're going through the distribution route, and we're using the US first. We're putting the product through a 510k application process with the FDA, which is a notification for us to be able to sell the product on the market. And we're setting up the distribution route, and we also set up OEM products with the heart valve manufacturers who wish to sew on this sort of product onto the heart valve. So we've got two avenues to head into the Rua vascular business.
You've got 1 minute left.
Thank you. The Rua valve heart business, this is an area that we have developed a novel heart valve polymer system, and again, replacing a mechanical or an animal-based heart valve with the elastion particular performances that allow us to take that forward. And we've got through the prototype stage, and we're producing a novel manufacturing technology to take that forward. Moving on rapidly. So the Rua Medical business that I sold into the group is basically the engine room of the group, and will provide all the skills and manufacturing for the two products that we've talked about. But also we manufacture for third party customers, so we have our income of our own in that particular area. So just to finish off. As I mentioned back there, we're very much focused in getting the products commercialized and getting it approved with regulatory submissions and the 510K in the area, the US region, and then following along with the CEA, the CE marking and the CA, now that being the UK now as Brexit has happened. We're very much focused on getting this product to market. We've spent the last year going through and being very focused in getting the technologies correct and producing the product and getting the testing done for the submission. So we're now making great progress in the marketplace for selling the product on. We've got a lot of the key opinion leader involved in the, so the rock stars of the aortic surgeons are all very interested in this area. And some of the comments coming back are that they're talking about it being game changing. Disruptive is another word that the product's coming through. So behind the technology platform that we've developed in the last year, we have got a good pipeline of products. The we're working through a different range of graphs and different products that will use the same technologies that we're investing in to ramp up our production within the clean room facilities in Irvine here in Scotland. Just a quick, we've been very challenged in the business going through COVID, but we have made great leaps and bounds forward with the technologies that we've put in place and the products that we've developed. And we're in a great position to move forward into getting our regulatory submissions within this year. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm glad you mentioned the submissions. Let's just refine those timelines a little bit. So you've got graft and patch product regulatory submissions on the horizon. Are we talking about, you know, before the end of second quarter 2021 and by the end of 2021, respectively?
Yeah, what we're looking at in the FDA submissions, that we're gathering all the information at this particular stage and putting our 510K application into the FDA for the grafts initially. So within that, we can get three graft products in there. That's the straight graft, the aortic root graft. There's two types of that. So we've actually got three products being submitted in the first 510K application. And then closely following along behind that, we'll have the vascular patch. So what we've done in the initial phase was to do the difficult one, to do the tube and the difficult. Now we're doing the patch is just a bit of flat fabric with the coating on top of it. So we're now moving into that phase that we're producing that forward. And then as soon as we get that, we'll be moving into our pipeline and moving the technologies forward. So different size bore grafts and basically coming down in size to down to small bore.
Okay, so you are on the pathway to commercialization. Robin Maxwell asks, what is a realistic timeline for the heart valve product if everything went swimmingly?
Everything's in the heart valve side of the product. We've got through the initial prototype. We're looking at a very novel method of manufacture, and we would hope to be moving towards first in man within a couple of years.
And Alex Simpson, in a roundabout way, is asking when you hope the company will be profitable.
Well, we're obviously working for that. And I mean, what we're doing is the working with the vascular graft is what we would term as the low hanging fruits, the easiest to get into the marketplace. So as soon as we get into that market and get selling there, that business will be able to provide us and take us towards profitability.
Excellent. Well, hopefully that will be sooner rather than later. But, you know, this could be huge. So Alex has a supplementary question, which is, you know, how much skin in the game do you have? How much of the stock is owned by management in terms of percentage?
Yeah, the management, the directors and the management hold just under 10%. As part of the acquisition, I became a major shareholder in the business. Definitely seeing the future of the Elastome product moving into all the different medical devices. That's what really attracted me to sell my company into the group. And I'm obviously heavily involved in the manufacturing and developing side of the business. And I see great opportunities for the Elastome platform to be sold into a wide range of products going forward. But we're certainly working hard towards getting the first product commercialized we'll see that towards the end of the year.
David, thanks very much indeed. And thank you for the education. Who knew that Rua was Gaelic for red? But now we...
There you go. It's going a bit grey these days, but it's still a darker shade of red.
There you go. It's still elegant. David Richmond, Chief Executive of Rua Life Sciences. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Sarah.
You're welcome. Okay, time now, 11:31, and something a bit edgy now. Listed on AIM since 2010, a venture capital company, TMT Investments, has for over a decade been investing in edgy early stage technology companies, including cloud storage and my favorite, wine delivery by the glass. The company's market cap is $264 million. Iga Scheufert is investment partner. Welcome.
Hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to present here. I guess I'm one of very few people without proper English accents. I was born in Russia, in Siberia, of all places, and lived in California, lived in the US for the last 26 years. As you would see in the presentation, the company is quite international, and that actually is a significant strength, because what we do is we capture the attention of the best startups before they're well known. And so this gives us an opportunity to invest pretty early, to invest in deals that typically are reserved more or less to the recent Horowitzes and Sequoias of Silicon Valley. And as hopefully the presentation will demonstrate, we do quite well for a company that listed 10 years ago. This data is from our latest report. However, the market cap is indeed significantly higher right now. The price per share is significantly higher right now, about 50% of what it is on this slide. What we have done in the last 10 years is really turning a pretty small nifty, if I could say so, startup venture capital company into a company that enjoys significant recognition in the segments where we invest. And I will try to persuade you in this presentation that what we've been doing for the last 10 years has been not only successful numerically, but actually prepared a pretty good foundation for hopefully continued success in the coming few years. A quick look at the shares. Once again, you could much faster than I open the slide look at how shares are doing. This is as of December. Right now, things are significantly better, and indeed the company enjoys a market cap and the price that is about 50% higher than what it is on this slide. The team definitely sets us apart. Myself and Yuri are two key people of the company who are based in the United States, Yuri in Boston, myself in San Francisco. My background is a very active angel investor, over 100 deals, and the creator of several reasonably large startups, the biggest being Fotki.com with 25 million users. Yuri's background is as a senior VP at Barclay, Lehman, and Citibank. We also have a support team in former Soviet Union, in Russia, Ukraine, and a couple of other places. It really helps us significantly to capture the attention of fast-growing young startups and to get valuations that are much more advantageous than the typical valuations you get when companies get to rounds B and C. We also have a good presence in both European Union, mostly the Baltics in Israel, and in the United Kingdom, where our executive director, Alexander Selaginev, is based in London. If you look at our investment process, I would say it's rather well formalized, and what we believe in is in creation of a significant deal flow, so that as an investor, we don't need to invest in good enough deals, but rather we have to say no to quite a few pretty good deals just because we see deals that are better. As you all know, a huge deal flow is really helpful with is, as an investor, you see quite a lot of alternative deals. So you know a lot about different business models, about different customer acquisition strategies, and you don't just listen starry-eyed to another wonderful startup telling you that it's absolutely unique, because chances are you've seen quite a few absolutely unique startups that are doing almost the same. But this huge funnel that we've developed over years through connection with angel investors, accelerators, other VCs through a lot of work, including a lot of pro bono and nonprofit work with startups, really helps us in understanding both the segments where we invest, as well as in discovering the new segments where, you know, from time to time, VCs typically learn that it makes sense to discover new opportunities and to boldly go where no other investors seemingly have gone before. This again is a little bit outdated. The value we created is much more significant by now, but it sort of gives you a snapshot as of a few months ago in December of 2020, where we invested, how much we generated. We had 14 profitable exits, which is pretty unusual for an early stage VC company. We were the very first investors in three unicorns, which is also very unusual for an early stage VC company. These are Bolt, probably most known by most of the listeners here because it's pretty active in London, so I don't need to explain what they do. It's HeiQ, which was acquired by Citrix for $2.25 billion several months ago, and it's Pipedrive, which was acquired by Vista, one of the largest private equity companies in the US, for $1.5 billion. We were the very first VC investors in all three, and strategically, what we're trying to do is to be the very first VCs in fast-growing companies. And in order to achieve this, what we're doing day and night, literally, is hunting for great deals, hunting for great startups, networking, participating in panels and conferences, creating our own gatherings, seminars, just basically offering free help to a lot of startups. If you look at our portfolio, and this is after several big exits, the largest by far company is Backblaze. It's a competitor of Amazon S3, Google, Microsoft in providing online storage, only it does it at about 20-25% of the price that Google and Amazon offer. And it has over 500,000 of paying subscribers, both businesses and individuals storing a lot of data. It's Bolt, which I already mentioned. It's Deposit Photos, which is world's fourth or fifth largest photo stock and video stock agency. It's Sandbird, one of the largest perfume subscription businesses, 500,000 of paying users. It's PandaDoc, which is a document management software, and it's a whole bunch of other companies. What's really interesting about this portfolio is that the companies, five top companies comprising more than 75% of our holdings, grew last year in revenues at more than 65%. So you could argue that the best is yet to come, although of course this is a forward-looking statement. In terms of where we invest, we really mostly favor segments where we learned that the incumbents are not too strong and too oppressive, where we learn that there are quite a few deals possible, where we see pretty active M&A market, and where M&A multiples really encourage us to invest more. So as you can see for yourself, big data, software as a service, e-commerce, specifically subscription, edutech, and marketplace are really the main areas where we invest, mostly for those reasons. No oppressive incumbents, lots of opportunities for companies to grow, very active M&A professionals there, and pretty attractive M&A multiples. So we will probably continue in those five areas, and you see this little other. And what that means is that from time to time, we do discover new segments where we try to find a lot of new companies to invest in.
One minute left.
Oh, great. I'm pretty much done. This is a snapshot of the portfolio of some of the companies are more advanced, others less. These are notable revaluations of the companies that we have in the portfolio. As you see, quite a lot of significant ones. This is a list of our exits, all of which are quite profitable. And this is a list of large venture capital companies investing after us. Some accolades by the press, and you know, happy to answer any questions about TMT.
Okay, so those accolades, hopefully more will come, because you said the best is yet to come. Possibly forward-looking statement, which takes me to Darren Nathan's question. He says, Iga, how has your sector focus evolved over the last decade, and what might be the next big thing?
That's an excellent question. Thank you. I think, again, like I said, the main reason why our outlook on the markets continue to evolve is because we see new opportunities, new tech, and a lot of new M&A activities. I would say we started paying a lot more attention to fintech. We started looking more into education. We actually, in the past, only made one investment, and in the recent past, we made quite a few more. We will probably see a lot of activity in virtual reality and augmented reality, and we see how e-commerce is just totally eating up retail. So hopefully we'll make more bets there.
Okay, let's go to the competition. Niall Pearson says, hello. Now, how fierce is the competition to provide growth capital into exciting companies? And how do you differentiate yourselves from larger VC private equity houses?
I would say that this slide with a lot of billion-dollar plus investors following up on our investments probably answers the question the best. There are dozens of billion-dollar plus VCs that follow up on our investments. I would say on the one hand, yes, indeed, the competition is quite fearsome. But on the other hand, most of these companies invest in rounds B, C, et cetera, and they don't really realize such significant increases in valuation, right? When you invest in companies at $300, $400 million, keeping in mind that only 5 to 10% of exits happen at billion-dollar valuation, you don't look to, you know, become multi-X company. And we increased our value significantly. Where we do sort of demonstrate more value is, as I mentioned, we have quite a lot of people in Eastern Europe, you know, specifically Ukraine, Belarus, Baltic Republics, Russia, former Soviet Union, where a lot of brilliant entrepreneurs are coming, but these are pretty tiny markets for them to do anything. So typically they're moving to where I live, which is San Francisco, or to where Yuri lives, Boston, New York, etc. And that's where we catch them. We also catch them because my co-founders, co-founded the very first high-tech unicorn in Eastern Europe called RBC, so a lot of us are well-known by them.
Okay, final question is from Pavel Fedorov, who says, as electrical transport industry is on the rise already, are you planning to invest in this sector and in infrastructure for e-cars?
We are very actively monitoring those deals. We actually looked just a couple of weeks ago into a company in Silicon Valley that provides sort of a cloud electric charging for electric vehicles. We're quite interested, but decided not to go forward because it's requiring too much capital. We're a small VC firm. We definitely would look there. I want to say that we do not have yet much expertise. But in terms of expertise, this is definitely a top 10 area. So I would say we're looking there, but we haven't made any investments yet.
Okay, this is probably a yes or no answer due to time. Backblaze market rumors is that it's preparing for an IPO. Do you think that will happen?
I can't comment on that one.
Sorry. That's no problem at all. Igo Schoifut, investment partner at TMT Investments. Thank you very much indeed. That was a very unfair question to ask finally. Thank you very much.
Brilliant questions too. Cheers.
Thank you. And thank you to all of you asking, again, the superb questions. We are now into our final company of the morning session, and it's another exhilarating one. It's Intelligent Ultrasound, market cap of roughly £45 million. It develops artificial intelligence-based clinical image analysis software tools for the diagnostic medical ultrasound market. Stuart Gall is the chief executive.
Thank you. So yes, I'm Stuart Gall, I'm CEO of Intelligent Ultrasound. And for those of you that don't know the company, we specialize in medical ultrasound, and our vision is to harness the power of the next generation of AI algorithms to make ultrasound simpler to use and easier to learn by giving clinicians training, guidance, and support whilst they're scanning, and ultimately trying to give ultrasound to everyone. But what does that mean? What is ultrasound for everyone? Well, from our perspective, that's all about a classroom to clinic approach. So we sell high fidelity simulators into the hospital classroom and teach doctors how to scan with ultrasound. And then we follow them into the clinic, onto the patients, and we give them AI-based software tools that help them scan faster and help them scan better. So that's where we're currently focused, but we do see a future where the technology comes down in price and people start to be able to plug small ultrasound devices into their phones, where providers of AR software may be able to sell to the consumer health assessment tools that utilize ultrasound. And I'll talk a little bit about more about that as we go on. So in terms of the classroom, so this is our simulation division. This business basically makes some of the world's leading ultrasound simulators. We have had three products that we sold to the market in 2020. So the first one of those is a product called Bodyworks Eve. And Bodyworks Eve is a full body simulator that teaches point of care and emergency medicine ultrasound scanning skills. Now, really importantly, over the last 18 months, we developed a COVID-19 module that enabled frontline clinicians who didn't have much experience in ultrasound to be able to learn how to do lung scanning and triage patients for COVID. We were effectively used in London, New York, Ohio, Los Angeles, and a number of other cities in the world to train clinicians over the last 18 months. And that set us in very good stead going forward. We have a product called Scan Trainer that is for obstetrics and gynecology, and that was upgraded in 2020. HeartWorks is about echo and anesthesia. We added a new augmented reality tablet object to that in 2020. And then in 2021, at the beginning of this year, we've launched a new product, which is the first AI-enabled training simulator, and that's for teaching peripheral nerve block. And the three platforms that we talked about last year sold about 5 million in quite a difficult COVID year, but we've actually now sold over 1,000 systems globally and see ourselves being well set up to grow this part of the business going forward. So into the clinic, and our clinical business is all about clinical AI. So we have a two-pronged go-to-market strategy. We have a on-machines, which is all about selling or signing royalty-based licenses with the major ultrasound manufacturers. We signed our first deal with GE, biggest ultrasound manufacturer in the world, for a product called ScanNav Assist, which is all about automated image analysis for protocol-based scanning in obstetrics and women's healthcare. And that first license software was integrated onto the new GE Swift machine end of last year, which is a big tick in the box for us. And then secondly, because you can't sign licenses when you want to or get the right amount of money from the OEMs or get them signed in the time you want, we decided to bring our own product range to marketplace, selling our own hardware with the software embedded in it that can plug into any ultrasound machine. And the first one of those was brought to market this year, ScanNav Anatomy, which is about highlighting the anatomy automatically for the doctor while they do ultrasound guided needling. That first product received CE approval this year and has just been launched in the UK. So two big tick in the box for our first clinical AI products. A little bit more detail about those. So ScanNav Assist, that's an obstetrics product. As I said, it's been launched by GE Healthcare at the end of last year. It's called Sonalist on the GE machine. And it's the world's first AI tool that basically recognizes the 20 key views that you take in the 20-week mid-trimester fetal ultrasound examination. It incorporates our ScanNav Assist AI technology. It's an option on the GE Healthcare's new Swift machine. So every time that option is taken up by the doctors, we get paid a royalty. And Swift is one of three ultrasound machines in the Voluson women's healthcare range. And we would hope that this product will expand over the coming years onto all those machines. I've got a few images to show it here. This is Sonalist in action. On the left-hand side, you can see the doctor using it. Now, this is all about trying to reduce examination complexity by giving a clinician, a sonographer, or easy-to-use automated tools that optimize and enhance the image and workflow, make it easier to do things while still enforcing standards and consistency of scanning. So what the image does is when the image is frozen by the correct image is frozen by the doctor, our software automatically confirms that that image has met the protocol. So you can see here a profile view of the baby. There are three elements that you have to see in that view. And because the software is recognizing them, it gives them a tick, allows the doctor to save it. If it didn't see them, it wouldn't be showing the green dots on the image saying that image meets the standard. It then automatically selects the correct biometry tool. So for example, if the image was of a head, it would automatically pull up the head measurement tools for the doctor. And then at the end, it confirms the scan is complete. So if you try and shut down the scan early, you can see on the box on the bottom right how it's showing that three elements of the scan, the profile, the kidneys, and the transverse thoracic view have not been taken. And so the doctor knows actually they need to take those images before they shut down. So we're excited about the fact that this is on machine for the first time and has taken us into our revenue phase of the business. So the second area that we spoke about was this is our own product that we're not selling to manufacturers at the moment. We plug this into the retrofit pool. So any machine in the anaesthetist marketplace can have this product plugged into it. You can see it in the middle picture, how it plugs into the side of the ultrasound machine. And what it does is basically, it's for ultrasound guided regional anaesthesia procedures. That's local anaesthesia. If you imagine if you have an operation on your arm or your hand or your leg, you can have a local anaesthetic rather than a general anaesthetic. That's better for the patient because it's safer, it's better for the hospital because it saves money and is less complex. But the barrier to having more peripheral nerve blocks is that in the UK, only 5% of anaesthetists do 85% of all nerve blocks. And the 95 that don't do it said, actually, if they had more confidence with the ultrasound, they'd do more. So we've given them a tool to help them do that. It automatically highlights the key anatomy. You can see in color or live on our screen, it's showing you the muscle, the artery, the nerves. It also has inbuilt training support. And as I've said, it plugs into any existing ultrasound machine and gives now the 9 key peripheral nerve block procedures. So this product has just been launched. It was CE approved at the beginning of the year. It's on sale in the UK, and we are on, obviously, in the regulatory pathway for the US, and would hope that that will come about 6 to 9 months after we've passed CE, so sometime at the beginning of next year. Again, a big tick in the box for bringing AI, or the start of bringing AI revenues to the market. So we have some additional products. We have ScanNav Detect, which is basically enables you to doctor to flag an area of potential abnormality, and then so the patient can be triaged to a specialist. And we're also looking how, as the price of hardware comes down, that you can take the medical products that we've done and develop health assessment tools for the consumer. So selling apps onto the consumer that enable you to scan at home. And these are all products that are in areas of various elements of development. So you can see here, this is the summary slide of that. We've got ScanNav Assist, the obstetrics product, launch on Sonalist, on the Swift, and now it's about expanding it across the full range of GE soft ultrasound machines, and also bringing out other products. So a 12-week version, a 30-week version, a variant tumor version. So having multiple products with multiple licenses into the marketplace. The same for anatomy, launched in the UK, extending out to Europe under the CE approval. When we get FDA approval, moving into America, and again, extending that range out. So trying to move into other areas, other interventional radiology areas, and having multiple revenue lines from the anatomy product. In development, we've got prostate, lung, liver, and then potentially coming forward at some point, we're in early sort of proof of concept stage for how we can look at consumer-based apps. So if I summarize the business, 2020, well, certainly, to be honest, the last 3 years, we've achieved all our key clinical milestones. First AI software launched on GE and selling, first sales into global obstetrics market. Second product, our own product, received CE approval and now launched in the UK and going into the sales phase. We hit our key simulation targets, which to mitigate the impact of COVID, build a COVID module and then expand the range so we can grow those sales 21, 22 onwards. And we also hit our group targets, which was to basically reduce the losses, even though we're on reduced turnover in 2020, but also we strengthened our balance sheet last year, raising 4.8 million. And we hope that that will give us enough money to get to the point where we can get to that break even sort of profit inflection point. We've had a really encouraging start to 2021. And We've got a new office in Cardiff, centre of Cardiff. I would welcome anyone that wants to come to one of our technology open days. You can have a hands-on feel and play with touch and feel everything that we make and develop in both the simulation and AI side. And we hope you can invite you down anytime you want. So that's me finished.
You've tickled me, Stuart, by saying, come on down to Cardiff, hands-on. I haven't heard words like that being used for over a year because
funny enough, we've had to build, and to be honest, the whole way we sell got massively affected, because when you send to hospitals, just like the ultrasound manufacturers, you actually have to go to the hospitals to sell, and that got taken away from us last year. So we had to build these sort of quite sophisticated web demonstration rooms where all our products are in the room, so we can do live online demos with multiple screens and pictures of the doctor scanning. That then gets played into the hospital. You've got the salesperson online as well, and you've got this sort of three-way call going on. And actually, that has started to work. And it'll be interesting to see if that carries on post-COVID, because it's a better and more effective way of selling something that's quite expensive to sell, because you've got to ship so much product in to the hospital.
Very good. Well, thank you for that invitation. You're probably going to be swamped now. So the key areas are assist, anatomy, detect, health check. There's more under development, which leads me to Siddharth Bhaskar's question, which is, can you just elaborate on the competitive landscape and who is the competition, the key competition?
Well, this is a very competitive landscape. I mean, there's AI everywhere. I think you've got competition from all the major manufacturers are doing AI. You've got new entrants into the marketplace like Butterfly. You've got big American, Israeli companies with lots of money backed. We found all our research was based on Oxford University. We've got a very specialist professor who's a leader in her field, and we specialize in ultrasound. And we think that's given us advantage, whereas a lot of the other research has gone into CT scanning, MRI, X-ray, etc. So by specializing in ultrasound, we feel that we've got a small lead, and it's about trying to keep it. And but there's no doubt there's a lot of competition out there, and I wouldn't want to tell anyone otherwise.
Okay, this is quite an interesting question. It might need a little bit of explanation from you. Robin Maxwell asks, is there any suggestion that ScanNav was destined for a partnership which has not materialized in the time expected?
I think what is meant there is that, so ScanNav's the AI, what we call all our AI products. The Assist was the first product that we signed a deal with GE on. We had hoped that anatomy, we would do a deal with a manufacturer. COVID got in the way of that, but that was one of the reasons why we always had our second prong strategy of bringing that to market ourselves. We still hope and believe that we will sign up with a manufacturer, and think that also clearly by bringing our own product to market, that might well accelerate that. But in effect, it has enabled us to still bring our product to marketplace and actually take it through CE approval ourselves. And we're well down the path of the FDA process as well. However, you are right. We hope that we will also sign an OEM deal for all our products. But at the moment, we haven't signed that for anatomy.
And one of your summarizing phrases was you're really looking forward to achieve that break-even inflection point. Do you think it will come as quickly as 2022?
I've definitely never said 2022. I think we're like any small company who is loss making. We're trying to juggle cash, all our resources, all our investment, and then forecast revenue and keep a balance of all of them. So where we've been for the last 3 to 6 months, the fact that we've got first products into market and now it's about GE selling them, etc. We think that gives us, whether we've got about 6 million left in the bank, that would give us enough to get to that point. We're constantly juggling it. I absolutely hope we're going to do it. And we're going to try and do everything we can to do that.
What's exciting you the most? Put your inventor's hat on.
I think there's two. One is actually having your first AI product that's the world's first in the market for obstetrics with GE, the biggest manufacturer in the world. Fantastic. But I also see that long term, there is real excitement about if you could scan yourself at home. I think that's potentially fantastic and could be really exciting. But let's see where that goes.
It's a new take on selfies, isn't it?
Yeah, it would be. Yeah.
Stuart Gall, Chief Executive of Intelligent Ultrasound, thank you for being a really elegant final presentation of a very exciting morning session. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thanks.
So there you go. That is the end of the morning session. We do have an afternoon session, which will start at about 10 to 1. Now, if you haven't signed up for the afternoon session, do go to the events page on proactiveinvestors.co.uk. Go to the events tab and you will find the invitation there. I look forward to seeing you. We've got some really good companies this afternoon. Find out why the bison is brave. Okay, go out, get some vitamin D. I will be back chatting away at 10 to 1.